As you can see, not all BMWs are created equal. You see that awesome convertible over there? It's for 60 grand or something. And then we just looked this one up, $42,000 for a glorified go-kart. And that's what Smart Growth's all about. 250 square foot apartment, charged the same as a 2,000 square foot apartment, have built-in regulations and zonings that you have to pay, so more can be paid in taxes and more to the rent controllers. Same thing with smart cars, smart meters, control your thermostat, rip you off, scam you. This is what it's all about, getting you to trade out luxury, quality for this, in austerity, with your carbon indulgences to feel good about yourself. This is how the globalists operate. This is what they're doing. Again, this is part two of the video here. Alex Jones here with you. My buddy Pat Riley is driving me in to an important meeting today.
We're in an electric car, by the way.
We are in an electric car. David Knight is going to be hosting. I have conjunctivitis. I think I've only had this one more time in my life. I'm not sure. I'm going to the doctor. My eye, I woke up this morning, it's completely swollen shut. If I open it, excruciating pain. So I need to put some coil silver in it. But in fact, I was so painful this morning, I didn't even think to do that. But David Knight's hosting the broadcast. There's so much I wanted to cover today, but I'm going to try to come in and during lunch or something and break down some of the stuff that's happening. All I know is there's a lot of key information at InfoWars, InfoWars.com.
Oh, no.
Look, ladies and gentlemen, a $42,000 starting German go-kart that barely seats anybody, but it's for the Earth, so it's okay now. Alex Jones signing off for InfoWars.com. Because remember, Agenda 21 and anything called smart is a globalist scam to rip you off and make you pay more by tracking and surveilling you. To learn more, visit InfoWars.com.
Okay, and Alex is reporting from the road, and he's behind that small car. They're laughing about it, but at least you can drive it. Okay, if they get their way, you're not going to have the ability to have any control over your transportation. That's one of the key things that is concerning. And we'll talk briefly today about what's going on here in Austin with Uber. Now, Alex was having somebody drive him to the doctors there because, in Austin, they've just had Uber shut down operations and Lyft on Monday because they didn't get their way with the Austin City Council. Now, Austin City Council here, just in case you don't know, is really the People's Republic of Austin. These people are unbelievable control freaks, straight out of California-style government. They want to dictate everything down to the bags that we use at the grocery store in Austin. That's why I don't live there. Nevertheless, when you look at the back and forth between Uber and Lyft, I'm not sure which side I would choose there because, frankly, what is happening with Uber, with Lyft, with GM, with Ford, with Volvo, all of these companies are getting together. They're going to government at the highest level. They're going to try to override these regulations by going up the chain of command, as we've now established it. It's not a constitutional chain of command because we do still have the Ninth and Tenth Amendment, but they are, of course, dead letters to the people in Washington, D.C. And so what they're trying to do is to shut down regulation of them, and they want different regulations than we have for taxi drivers. And we're going to play a little bit of a report that I had back in Washington, D.C., when we were covering the Pope. I talked to a taxi driver there. You won't believe the difference between regulations that the taxi drivers have and the stuff that Uber and Lyft are so upset about that they completely suspended operations. Look, I'm not a regulation guy, okay? I don't like a government like the city of Austin that wants to regulate everything in our lives. But the even worse than the regulations is the fact that you've got two tiers of regulations. One for the big guys at the top, another one for everybody else. We're also going to be talking today to Michael Schneider, frequent contributor to InfoWars.com, as well as an HSB whistleblower, John Cruz. So stick with us. We've got a lot of news and some very important interviews. Welcome to the Alex Jones Show on this Tuesday, May 10th, 2016. I'm David Knight, your host today. We have an interesting article from Breitbart about what happened on Mother's Day weekend in Chicago. That city of love. We had 43 people wounded, 9 killed in Chicago gang violence. Now, I'm still waiting to see if they're going to blame this on Donald Trump or maybe his supporters. Or I'm sure it's firearms in the Second Amendment. But never never will it be blamed on the gangsters themselves, on the thugs who are actually doing this, because that's the way this all plays out. You know, when we had these Trump rallies and we had the mainstream media and Ted Cruz blaming Donald Trump for the violence at his rallies, we were told, and I've heard people on mainstream media who are defending this narrative that these guys were to blame, say, well, you know, he deliberately provoked that by going to Chicago, of all places, and even going to the university where Bill Ayers teaches. Because, you know, you can't have free speech there. And you should expect that if you show up to talk about something that Bill Ayers and his thugs don't agree with, that they're going to get violent with you, okay? They're going to block ambulances. They're going to attack people's cars. Because, you know, that's just to be expected. Just like the lady shouldn't jog through Central Park because she should know that that belongs to the rapists, okay? Here's the deal, okay? We're going to get in people's faces, and we're going to take back our country, and we're not going to be intimidated by political correctness. We're not going to be intimidated by violence. And the people know better than this. We've had the former governor of Pennsylvania, who is going to be chairing the Democrat National Committee meeting where they choose the nominee, because it's going to be in Philadelphia. I guess they chose him for that. And he said, we're going to have a vote, and we're going to offer up Bernie Sanders and put his name in nomination. We're going to have a vote. He's going to lose that vote. And then his supporters better behave themselves. Why would he say that? Why would he say that Bernie Sanders supporters need to behave themselves? Because the left themselves really know who is responsible for this. Donald Trump isn't going to be there, but they know because they're already doing it. Hillary Clinton in some places, they know that these people are acting like thugs, like radical revolutionaries. They believe that there is, or should be, no restriction on their actions. That's what is behind all of this. Now, there's an interesting article up on the Drudge Report from The Guardian. A couple of links there. The rise of the militias. And I wanted to cover this because, of course, we've been out to Oregon multiple times, and we've talked about the land use issues that are there because it's not only what happened at the Malheur incident, but it was what happened before that. The heavy-handed injustice of the federal government coming after that family for arson, and it clearly was not arson, and the fact that everybody stood down out there. But there's also been issues on the other side of Oregon with miners, with loggers also. We've seen this all across the area. Well, what's happening now, and The Guardian reports on it, is we now have a political movement that is rising out of this. Because you know what? These people are trying to do this the right way. They stood up to the thugs who were abusing their neighbors in Utah and Nevada. People came together and said, you're not going to do that here. You're not going to take the land from us. You're not going to run the last rancher out of here. Who has land rights? And this is what's important. We mentioned this over and over again. People in the cities, people in the suburbs need to understand that they have property rights that are essentially the same as the property rights you have on your home. They have surface rights. They have mineral rights. They have water rights. All these rights can exist on the same piece of land. And the people who are reporting this are deliberately spinning this in the urban media, trying to tell people who don't understand what these rights are that have belonged in many cases to these families for 100, 150, 170 years, some of these mining rights. You can have all of these rights coexisting on the same piece of land. So these people are not saying, I own this government land. No, they're saying, I have land rights here that I've had for a very long time, whether it's grazing or water or mineral or logging rights. These are rights. And these are property rights. And we, as a people, need to stop letting the government run roughshod over our property rights. We need to stand up when they do it to the farmer. We need to stand up when they do it to the inner city person who is a minority and they just seize their car, seize their cash under civil asset forfeiture. Or when they do it to a group of traveling musicians who've just finished raising, as a Christian band, finished raising over $50,000 for orphanages. They pull them over, they find the cash and say, oh, that's got to be drug money. We're going to take that. And we're not going to charge you with anything, and you're going to have to sue us in civil court if you've got the money to try to get your money back. That's the way they operate. This was put in, by the way, by the Reagan administration. So when we talk about conservative values, I hope those conservative values will in someday will include valuing private property, valuing the Bill of Rights. Why don't we include those in conservative values someday? okay? Every time I hear the Republican Party go off on this Reagan worship, it's like, oh, really? Really, you want to talk about private property rights? You want to talk about the Brady Bill? You want to talk about a whole bunch of other things, mandatory minimums, where we have shut down sections, entire sections of the Bill of Rights under Ronald Reagan? Okay, let's talk about maybe not conservatism. Let's just talk about liberty, okay? I don't really care about keeping the status quo, but let's talk about what's going on in Oregon, according to The Guardian. It's an interesting story because it's also interesting to look at their perspective. And when I saw this article, one of the people who was reporting on what happened in Idaho at the Malheur occupation is a guy named Michael Emery. And he was with the Voice of Idaho. We've interviewed him multiple times. He stayed there for a very long time. He was arrested this weekend by the FBI. They say there's a weapons charge. I haven't been able to vet that yet to see if that's a real deal or not. So anybody has any information on that, send that to me at davidk@infowars.com because I really want to find out what's going on. Michael Emery, when I talked to him, seemed like a level-headed guy. He didn't seem like the kind of guy who would steal a 50 caliber machine gun from his former employer. That really didn't seem to jive with the person that I talked to. So I would like to know more about that. But let's talk about what's going on here. They say the Patriot Movement surge is due partly to fear and a perceived indifference of political leaders to places that didn't recover from the 2008 crash. So, see, this is the fear of these rednecks that is causing this to rise. No, it's not. No, it's not, Guardian. They have absolutely no understanding of the issues that are involved here. This is a deliberate effort to shut down these economies, to drive people out of these rural areas so they can force everybody into the cities, so they can control our movement with these self-driving cars. Okay? This is all about controlling and constricting your movement, confining you into cities, putting people essentially on reservations, shutting down their ability to create goods and services that we need in those areas. It is a much bigger issue than that. It is about fundamentally about our freedom. It is about the Constitution. But let's look at what they have to say here. They focus on a guy named Joseph Rice, who is running in Josephine County for the office of county commissioner. That's in southwest Oregon. I believe Josephine County is where that mine was, the Sugar Pine Mine, that happened before the Malheur standoff. But they say the Patriot leader doesn't present himself as a crazed gun nut, nor as a blowhard white supremacist. No, of course he doesn't, because that's your stereotypes at The Guardian, at the Southern Poverty Law Center that creates these stereotypes. These are the ridiculous stereotypes that you have created. I've talked to these people over and over again in these areas. They are not crazed gun nuts or white supremacists. That's the label you constantly attach to them, and it is a complete lie. And of course, they have to say that because now they're talking about an individual. So they can't just broadly tar all these people with that issue. They say, but talk to him long enough, and a Patriot leader returns to what really drives him, land, okay? And that's really property rights and our respect and our guarantee of those property rights under the Constitution. You know what? If you don't own property, what are you? You're a slave. You're a serf. Just as Gerald Celente says, they want everybody to live in this service economy. Okay, and what's another name for a service economy? Well, you want to be a servant? You want to be a slave? You want to be a serf? You're not going to make any money doing that, okay? This is hard work that these guys do out in these areas. These ranchers, miners, loggers, they work really hard, and they deserve every penny they get, and they get paid better than flipping hamburgers at McDonald's, okay? Now, they say that Rice believes the federal government's current role in land management is illegitimate, even tyrannical. No, really? He believes that? What have we been reporting on for the last 3 or 4 years? Of course it's illegitimate, and of course it is tyrannical. We've shown that time and again. They say his campaign's well advertised around the country, around the county, and appears well organized. His growing experience in organizing patriot groups and community watch organizations has polished his skills in retail politics. They say people whose ideas about land management broadly align with Rice and the now infamous Bundy clan are aiming for elected office in cities, counties, even the state houses. And again, we said over and over again, we thought that their strategy of taking control of that area there for such a long time, saying we're never going to leave. I mean, they didn't, you know, to do it for so long, we knew it was going to turn out this way. We knew it would spin that way. We thought it was a very bad strategy. But there's nothing that they did that should land any of them in jail. And that especially goes for what happened at the Bundy Ranch. I was there. I know what happened. I know what didn't happen. And I've read the indictment against the Bundys, and it is a pack of lies. They even indicted a guy from New Hampshire who didn't show up until a couple of days after the fact. And, of course, to them, it is a threat to the life of an FBI agent if you have a First Amendment protest accompanied by the legal carrying of firearms under the Second Amendment and under state law. That is considered to be a threat to the life of officers. That's what they're trying to do. They're even saying that Clive and Bundy, if I read the indictment correctly, looks to me like they're saying that he threatened with weapons these officers that were there. And I was there a couple of days before the standoff. A day or so after, I never saw him with a weapon, okay? He was not even at the standoff. And so it is a pack of lies. But they talk about, he proudly talks about his connection with Oath Keepers, a group that asserts that oath taken by soldiers and police is to the Constitution, not to politicians. Of course it is. The oath is to the Constitution. Why would we assert something like that? It's because it's true. We don't have a dictatorship. Not yet. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. We're going to be talking later in the show to Michael Snyder, frequent contributor to Infowars.com, about economic issues, his economic collapse blog, Signs of the Times, folks. We're also going to be talking in the third hour to John Cruz. Now, he is an HSBC whistleblower. We've talked to other HSBC whistleblowers in the past. We talked to Everett Stern. And John Cruz figured prominently in the confirmation hearings of Loretta Lynch, who we just saw yesterday, had a very emotional press conference to come after the people of North Carolina so that she could manage their bathroom laws, comparing them to Jim Crow laws. But of course, she has absolutely no problem with HSBC and other banks who are laundering billions of dollars, who are involved in the Forex exchange manipulation, making trillions of dollars a day. And they give them a slap on the wrist. We've been told, essentially, as Rolling Stones put it, these guys are too big to jail. That's what the Department of Justice under Eric Holder, and then they doubled down on it under Loretta Lynch. But, of course, we cannot allow the people of North Carolina, more importantly, the people whose property it is, the private property owners, the business owners, the churches, we cannot allow them to determine how they're going to do their own bathrooms. No, the federal government has to tell us how to go potty. And if they don't, then they're going to send down the lynch mob and the gay KK to take care of it. Now, before I get back to what I was talking about with the Patriot Act, but the Patriot candidates, these are real patriots, okay? The Patriot Act was just the opposite of patriotism, as we all know. But these are real patriots that are rising up out of the land issues, out of the private property issues, out of the people who do not want to be slaves, who do not want to be driven off their land by the King of Sherwood Forest, also known as the BLM. Before I do, I want to let you know about a new sale that we have. This is on ProPure Big or King units. These are water filters. And folks, if you're not filtering your water after what you've seen in Flint, Michigan, and right after that, we got a phone call from where we used to live in North Carolina. They still had our phone number on the register there. And they said, if you see some stuff that's real smelly in your water, a lot of color, don't worry about it. It's safe to drink. You know, maybe it is. The stuff you really have to worry about maybe is the stuff that you don't see, the stuff you don't smell, like the lead that was in Flint, Michigan. So if you get a ProPure Big Filter or a King unit, these are gravity-fed filters for your family's water, for your protection, for your family's protection. We will give you a choice of a free gift. Now, both of these gifts are about a $70 value. And you can choose from either a ProPure fruit-infused water pitcher. Now, this is like a counter pitcher that has a separate container for fruit, so you can put like lemons or oranges in there, and it flavors the water. Really nice thing that's there. Plus, it filters the water as well. Or you can get a ProPure ProMax shower filter that removes and reduces over 200 contaminants from the shower water, including things like heavy metals, fluoride, chlorine. You know, if you're in the city, they're going to be dumping fluoride and chlorine in. That's going to be coming to you in the hot water in the form of a chlorine gas. So you want to try to filter that out of your shower heads. If you live in a rural area, there's going to be pesticides, perhaps pharmaceuticals, maybe odors. So to get rid of all of that at your shower filter. So if you get a big ProPure filter or a King unit, you can take a choice of a free gift. Each of those are $70 value while this sale is going. And of course, we still have our 30 to 40% off all InfoWars Select storable food. I don't know how much longer they're going to be able to run that sale because That is a huge discount that we have off of our food. So I want to get back to what I was talking about with the Patriot candidates in Oregon. As we went to break, the Guardian, I was reading you the clip there, saying that Oath Keepers asserts that the oath taken by soldiers and police is to the Constitution, not to politicians. That's just an assertion, a baseless assertion by the Oath Keepers. Because, you know, you're really signing up when you take the oath, soldiers and police, you are really just going to be the hired minions of whoever is the dictator in chief at a given moment. But then they look at what's really driving this, the economic issues that are really driving this. When we talk to people who are in the mining industry, when we talk to people who are in that county there in southwest Oregon, they have lost 90% of what really drove that economy because it was driven by logging, and the feds came in and just said, no, we're going to stop all logging. But don't worry, we're going to give you 10 years of welfare benefits. Same kind of stuff that we see happening with Hillary Clinton. You know, they have the primary in West Virginia today, and Hillary Clinton, I guess she thought it was a good idea to go there and tell them that she was going to shut down their coal mines and take their coal jobs. But vote for me anyway, okay? Going to destroy your economy, but we'll transition you into some green jobs, and we'll put you on the federal reservation just like they did the Indians. We'll make you dependent on our welfare. We'll take away your ability to run your economy. Remember that and go to the polls today. I think Donald Trump is making a big mistake to tell people not to bother about voting in the primary. He needs to secure this nomination. It's not there yet. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. And as I mentioned before, we're going to be joined in the next hour by Michael Snyder, frequent contributor to Infowars.com. And in the third hour, we're going to be joined by John Cruz, a whistleblower about activities at HSBC, money laundering activities of drug cartels, terrorist organizations, who gave the evidence to the Justice Department, to Loretta Lynch. She didn't acknowledge it until she was questioned about it during confirmation hearings. And then she admitted, no, I didn't do anything with that. And of course, she didn't do anything even when they convicted HSBC multiple times of money laundering. They gave the Sinaloa cartel, El Chapo, had his own private checkout window where he could come and launder his money with HSBC. And of course, that's another whistleblower from HSBC. We're not going to be interviewing him today, but that's a guy who released a lot of information as to how they helped tax evasion in various countries. And he's now been convicted in absentia of a 5-year sentence out of Switzerland for violating their Banking Privacy Act. So I'm kind of ambivalent about what that guy did. But this guy is talking about how HSBC, and we've also had Everett Stern on in the past, talking about how they were convicted multiple times of laundering money for drug organizations, for drug cartels, for terrorist organizations. And first time they were given probation. Second time they were given a very, very small fine compared to the amount of money that was involved. But I just wanted to mention one final thing about this article talking about the rise of the militias and Patriot candidates now getting elected in Oregon. And of course, Oregon is a very, very blue state. I think it was a mistake for the Bundys to go there to take a stand, even though in the rural areas, the people understand the city, the county government, for the most part, the sheriffs, except with the exception of at least one that I know of that's there in Grant County, he's a good guy. But the rest of them are big government liberals who want to shut this down. They put a lot of pressure on the FBI to bring this to a resolution that resulted in the death of Lavoie Finicum, the unnecessary death. And of course, the FBI lied about what happened there. And we subsequently saw even the sheriff's county release the evidence. They saw a big hole in the roof and they said, wait a minute, that's not any caliber that we were shooting. The FBI said they didn't fire any shots. And then we learned that they fired sniper shots, perhaps trying to kill the people who were not shooting at them, who were inside the vehicle, perhaps trying to provoke them to firing back in self-defense and saying they were being the aggressors. Nevertheless, the FBI lied about it. But of course, the federal government is only upset about the fact that the FBI snipers the hostage rescue team. That's what I love. They have these guys who are nothing but government assassins. We saw what they did to Randy Weaver's wife, and they call them hostage rescuers. Okay. All right. You want to play that kind of semantic game? It's kind of like the Patriot Act, okay, folks? But when we look at what they did to Southwest Oregon, when they shut down all of the timber industry there, They took the economy down by 90%. They said, don't worry, we'll give you 10 years to adjust. But they say the budgets of Sheriff's Office, Juvenile Justice Center, the Adult Jail, the District Attorney's Office have all been cut by 65%. They can't even afford to pay for the government in that area. And the same thing is happening in John Day, Oregon, where we talked to the logger who was there. He pointed out that as they refuse to allow people to make a living to cut down dead timber out of these areas so that we can build homes and furniture and produce things, by leaving that dead timber there, they create circumstances that they're adding fuel to the fire, literally. When they have a natural fire, it turns into a catastrophe. And we've seen this happen over and over again. We've seen it happen in Oregon. We've seen it happen here in Texas, down south before I moved here. It happened down in Bastrop. We've seen that the policies of leaving this dead wood there is guaranteed to burn out the area. But they have burned down the economy, literally. And so they said in 2012, they even had to set free county prisoners. They couldn't afford to keep them in the jail. They had to shut down the sheriff's department. So, and here's a blessing in disguise. What they're starting to do now is they have started creating neighborhood watch programs. And this is a guy who's now running for office there. They've created resident deputies. We've talked about this in the past as well. The posse. Remember the model that we see in all the Westerns where you've got the sheriff and a couple of permanent deputies who really know what's going on? They become the leaders of the community. Posse comitatus, the power of the community. When there's a crisis, the people come together and they work with the professional elected and accountable to the people, law enforcement officer, the sheriff. And so they say they have resident deputies, community members who would take policing into their own hands. See, the Guardian, with their Southern Poverty Law Center biases, always has to turn this into a situation like, oh, they're vigilantes, okay? Nevertheless, there are some positive signs that are going on out there, and it's interesting to see how The Guardian tries to spin this. Now, there was also an article that was on Drudge yesterday I thought was pretty interesting. This was Washington Times reporting on Vanity Fair's take on the Captain America movie, because, of course, in Captain America, the people there are being spun as uncontrollable vigilantes. And we know that's not true because we've seen the other movies, right? But Vanity Fair said, well, this could be a perfect movie, except it's got one big flaw. They didn't leave any kind of homosexual relationship between Captain America and Bucky. Sorry if that was a spoiler. They put this out there and said, the problem is there's too much heterosexual virility there in that movie. And it's like, wow, wow, that's where we are. You know, we just rented, we were out of, we had power outages with a storm that came through where we live about a week and a half ago. And we were out of internet for about 8 or 9 days. And we normally watch movies through internet. So we wanted to watch something. We went literally to the bottom of the discount barrel bin trying to find something that we could watch one night. And we thought, oh, here's something. We got the Captain America Iron Man movie coming up. We found this movie that was an animated movie called Iron Man Extremis. And I wondered when that was made, because when you start out the movie, the first thing it shows is Bastrop, Texas. And it's like, wow, that's not far from where we live. And it's like, how about that? And then they go to the whole storyline is about these terrible anti-government extremists. And they get injected by this drug from a pharmaceutical company that works for the military-industrial complex in Austin. And this drug turns this guy into extremists without the T, just in case you don't want to get that too confused, too direct with the Southern Poverty Law Center narrative. So they just take the T off of it. They call him extremists, okay, without the T. This guy, you find out in the story, his whole family had something like the Randy Weaver situation. And what a surprise. This guy doesn't like the government. As a matter of fact, when he becomes this when he can see superpowers from this drug, he decides he's going to take out some of the people responsible in Washington. And so Iron Man steps into the fore there. You know, when you look at the movies that Marvel is creating, and I really liked the previous one, The Winter Soldier, a lot better. I was hoping there would be a political dimension to this one, because the previous one was very politically savvy, exposed the Nazi rat line that we call Operation paperclip where they brought the scientists over, exposed a lot of stuff. I think really made people think about where this whole surveillance state is leading and the power that we are giving the government, this unchecked power that we're giving the government. So I had a lot of hopes for this one that really didn't materialize from a political standpoint. I thought it was still a good action film. I thought it was still a very good film. But when you look at these movies, they're pretty mainstream with where American culture is today, I think. But not the comics. Because remember, we've had these Captain America comics coming out in the past, you know, where the Tea Party, they call them the Tea Baggers, and Captain America is fighting the Tea Party. And now we've got Iron Man going after this extremist out of Bastrop, Texas. I mean, they're using the movies, I think, to pull the kids in. The parents look at the movies, oh, yeah, those are pretty good movies. I really even liked Captain America. He's a great role model. And then your kids read these comics, and what they're getting is the hardline propaganda of the left. And here's an article today. This is from Breitbart. Harvard professor urges liberals to treat evangelical Christians like Nazis. And he says, hey, we've had a culture war, and we won that culture war. And so you shouldn't treat them with any more deference than we treated the people we defeated in World War II. You know, you should just rub their noses into it like we did Germany and Japan. It's like, well, yeah, the only problem is that we really didn't do that in Germany and Japan. We kind of learned a lesson after World War I. We did rub the Germans' noses in it after World War I, and that created World War II to a large degree, created the forces that did that. But he says we should offer Christians no quarter, no clemency. Like, wow, throw the mantle down. This is a 70-year-old professor, Mark Tushner. He said, they lost, we won. It's time to press the liberal advantage and abandon any defensive positions. He says they will no longer have any resistance, especially after the death of Supreme Court Justice Antonin Scalia. And when I look at this, I say, well, you know what? He really is kind of right. They really have beat Christians in the culture war. Why is that? Why is that? You know, we look at the back and forth that's happened here in the presidential race, and we see what Glenn Beck and Ted Cruz did. They were basically channeling and taking to the next degree these ideas that began with the Christian Coalition coalescing around Ronald Reagan. The idea that we should trust government to modify society. That government is not a fire that needs to be kept in check, like George Washington said, but that it is a force of social engineering. See, the conservatives bought into that social engineering idea as well. And they also, just like this liberal, says, well, it's all revolves around the Supreme Court. And we saw that in Ted Cruz's website, where he talked about he's going to restore the Constitution. How is he going to do it? Well, it's all about the Supreme Court. We need a generation of conservatives who are, we should call them the Andrew Jackson generation. And they should say, well, the Supreme Court has made their ruling. Let's see them enforce it. Because we have a lot of powers that are divided in our government by design. That's in the Constitution. We have a 9th and 10th Amendment that underscores that division in the Constitution. Tells us where the real power lies. Tells us that unless they have been specifically granted this power to manipulate our lives, they don't have it. And so we need a Andrew Jackson-like president. We need people at the state level who will stand up like Andrew Jackson and say, you don't have the legitimate authority, just like these patriots in Oregon. You don't have the legitimate authority to do this. And when I look at the fact that we've got these conservative culture warriors, they've lost because they put their trust in government. Isn't that ironic that the conservatives who say they want limited government put so much trust in government to preserve their culture, to preserve the values that we've had? I think we need to take a two-pronged approach. First of all, we need to understand that we need to take the high road politically, and we need to say this is about individual liberty. We are going to rigorously enforce the Constitution, particularly the Bill of Rights. That's what we're going to do politically. And then I think the Christians need to understand that the power doesn't lie in a presidency. The power doesn't lie in the Supreme Court. The power, Christians, lies in Jesus Christ. And if you're not going to use that power, if you're going to get your army of clergymen to say, we've got to unite against around this messianic politician who's going to solve all of our problems, that's the fundamental problem with what happened with Glenn Beck and with Ted Cruz. And Alex Jones was exactly right. They were prancing demons. Okay? leading Christians down a path where they can't win because they have denied the true power to accomplish something. Now, I had an article here, and I misplaced it here, but there was also, here it is right here, 40,000 non-Muslim migrants harassed in German centers over their religion. That's the religion of peace, the religion of tolerance here, right? 40,000 Christians and other non-Muslim refugees, this is an RT story, currently residing in migrant centers in Germany are being discriminated against and harassed by other asylum seekers and even the guards because of their religion, says a human rights group. 88% said they were harassed by Muslim migrants due to being Christians. And they say that 42% of them were insulted, 37% got physical injuries, 32% even had death threats. They say women who've been rescued from ISIS slavery in the Syrian city of Raqqa say, quote, they are still unprotected. They even see their tormentors in these camps. How's that? Okay. Because we're not screening the people who come in. We're saying anybody that wants to can come in. And look at the way they're being treated. Look at the tolerance. You know, we've got our ally, Saudi Arabia, as well as ISIS, executing people because they're homosexuals, throwing them off of the roof, cutting their heads off, seeking the death penalty under Sharia law because they are homosexuals. I covered this last night. And yet, what is our government doing about that? Are we creating any sanctions against Saudi Arabia? No. We're defending Saudi Arabia. We're saying we're not going to release any evidence that might implicate them in their official conspiracy theory, okay? Because you could have 9/11 families sue them over that. They create a narrative where they've got 19 hijackers on two planes to take down three buildings, and then they say, yeah, they're from Saudi Arabia and so forth and so on. And then, unfortunately for them, some of the people lower down didn't get the memo, okay, the eyewash that's going on in these organizations where the people at the top know what's going on, but the people lower down actually are doing an investigation. They say, well, okay, if they're Saudis, where did they get their help? Where did they get their money here, okay? And they start exposing that, and they go, oh, no, don't let that out, because these guys are our friends, okay? The Saudis are our friends. The people who throw homosexuals off of the roofs are our friends. The people who cut their heads off are our friends. But we can get upset if we've got private bathrooms in North Carolina. We'll say, these are Jim Crow laws. Understand where this all began. And again, here's another example, Christians, of the way this has gone wrong. Okay? This all began by a guy named Chad Severance Turner. North Carolina Values Coalition exposed the fact that he was working with the LGBT Chamber of Commerce role in Charlotte. He was the one who created new bathroom laws that never existed before in Charlotte. This is a guy who is a registered sex offender. He fondled a child in church while the child was sleeping, and he is a registered sex offender. And then he comes in and says, hey, I've got a great idea for how we're going to do bathrooms, at which point the people of North Carolina were justifiably outraged. But instead of saying, no, we're not going to let you, Charlotte, create that law, we're going to override that with a law at the state level that says we're going to have people's are going to be able to exercise their private property rights, and they're going to be able to determine how they're going to set up their bathrooms. Instead, North Carolina came back and said, no, we've got a special thing we're going to do here for you. Throw the ball into their court. Now the feds came back and said, you guys are a bunch of racists. And so now we've got the Obama lynch mob coming down and suing them. So this is the way this happens. It could have been stopped by saying, we're going to support liberty. But instead, they tried to create their new solution. And this kind of escalation, this kind of thing, trying to solve everything at the government level, is what's causing them to lose the culture wars. Now, later on, we're going to have, stay with us, we're going to have not only our guest joining us in the next hour is going to be Michael Schneider, but we're also going to have a special treat for you later in the program. We're going to play a trailer for an as-yet unreleased Billy Corgan Smashing Pumpkins interview. We're going to have that trailer coming up for you. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host today. We're going to have, as I mentioned, in the next hour, Michael Schneider is going to be joining us. He's a frequent contributor here to Infowars.com. He talks about issues of preparedness, but especially about the economy. He has some very interesting metrics that show an economic slowdown is upon us, in case you hadn't noticed. Yeah, it is. We're also going to be joined in the third hour by John Cruz, an HSBC whistleblower. And as I mentioned before, his testimony about what was going on at HSBC figured prominently in the confirmation hearings of Attorney General Loretta Lynch, even though she did nothing with that information. It was something that the Republicans questioned her about and pointed out that they did not want to have a continuance of the too-big-to-jail attitude that we had seen from Eric Holder. Nevertheless, she did that, and we'll talk about what happened with that, and we're going to have him tell you what he saw at HSBC, what was so concerning to him. Before we get back to the news, I just want to let you know about a new sale that we have. And I mentioned this earlier in the show. If you get a ProPure Big or a King unit, you'll get your choice as a free gift. These are two choices, each of them about a $70 value. You can either get a ProPure fruit-infused water pitcher that brings together the natural benefits of fruit-infused water and the health benefits of filtered water all in one pitcher. You just put the, like I said, whatever you want to add, whether it's cucumbers or oranges or lemons, you can just put it in this container and it will flavor your pure filtered water in that container all in one handy unit there. Or you can get a ProPure ProMax shower filter that reduces and removes over 200 contaminants from your shower water. Things like fluoride, chlorine, pharmaceuticals, pesticides, odors, get that out of your shower. So you can get one of those two as a free gift if you buy the ProPure Big unit. That's the gravity feed filter that we have that can filter easily for a family the water that you get out of your tap. Also, we have continued on some of our best-selling InfoWars Select Storable Foods, the 30 to 40% off of the Select Storable Foods. And again, that is at InfoWarsStore.com. Huge discount, 30 to 40%. We've been able to extend that to some of our foods there at InfoWars Select Storable Food. Now, some of the news that came out today, of course, we've had Paul Ryan, very interesting, this back and forth that went on between him and Donald Trump over the weekend. Obviously caught him by surprise that Ted Cruz dropped out, but he wanted to put himself, I believe, when he would come out and he would make this comment, well, I'm not quite there yet. Yeah, he's not quite there yet. I mean, who would think that 2 days after another massive win by Donald Trump, after both of his competitors dropping out, who would think that if you went on and talked to a major news media organization, that they would ask you about Donald Trump? He just really hadn't thought about that enough yet. Need to think a little bit more time to think about that. Now, he was trying to put himself out there as the leader of the GOP establishment. Of course, he is their darling. They have put him in as Speaker of the House. And when I listen to all these never Trump people saying, well, I just don't know that Trump is good enough on the issues. I don't know that he's conservative enough. And it's like, please explain to me what is conservative about Paul Ryan. Please tell me. He's for open borders. He rubber stamped everything that Barack Obama wanted to do. They had the climate change accord that was struck in Paris back in December. He had some senators say, well, we're going to have something to say about that. No, they didn't. Within 3 days, they had fully funded that. They'd fully funded Obamacare. They had done absolutely nothing about the border. What does Paul Ryan do that is conservative? I'm waiting for somebody to tell me what he does that's conservative. Look, Donald Trump should ask him to step down. He says, hey, if he wants me to leave the chair of the convention post, I'll do it. I'll step down. He not only needs to tell him to step down from the convention post, but he needs to get involved in getting Paul Ryan out of office. Just like Sarah Palin was talking, we need to canter him out of office because he's going to be the biggest opposition to Trump. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. In the next segment, as I mentioned, we're going to be joined by Michael Snyder. We're going to talk some economic news, but I began talking about Paul Ryan. I think we need to start calling him Paul Ryan-O, as in Republican in name only. Just add an O to it, and it'll be perfect, because that is what Paul Ryan is truly about. As I was mentioning as we went to break, look at the older headlines. Paul Ryan betrays America. $1.1 trillion omnibus bill. And again, I said that should be called the omnibust bill, because you cannot keep raising the spending that way. Big spender for open borders, for the TPP, for the globalist multinational trade deals. Understand that he doesn't stand for a constitution. He doesn't stand for any conservative values. This guy is not conservative at all. These people are perfectly comfortable with Hillary Clinton because they share her same economic outlook, just as his running mate, Mitt Romney, shared Barack Obama's idea about how to take over health care. Romney had already done that in Massachusetts, Romney Care, that he did with Ted Kennedy. And Paul Ryan was his running mate. They knew they had Obamacare, whether it was going to be Obamacare or Romney Care, you were still going to have the crony capitalists write the regulations for the insurance business. And of course, the Republican Party has never had a plan to get rid of this. They never planned on getting rid of it. They never had any. They said, well, we're going to repeal and replace it. They never gave you any details. Donald Trump has given us a 7-point plan. As I've mentioned, it identifies all the issues: ownership, free market, competition, tax credits, all the things that we need to do to reform this, as well as transparency on cost so that we can make informed decisions of the health savings accounts that we own and can pass down. So we have ownership. We have an incentive to save. We have the ability to save. We have competition within the United States. Imagine that. Somebody like Paul Ryan, who supports the TPP, and his new challenger has dared him to debate the TPP. I like a lot of the stuff that his challenger, his name is Paul Neyman. So two Pauls here. Paul Ryan O, and Paul Neyman. And as his challenger says, Ryan has betrayed all of us. Yes, he has. He dares him to debate the TPP. I would dare him to debate how he could override the Constitution with the Trade Promotion Authority. You know, we have a process in the Constitution for ratifying treaties. And they're still saying, hey, all of these people like Kerry, and they all signed the treaty. All these government representatives signed the treaties. But it's got to go to ratification everywhere. Of course, it's a treaty. NAFTA was a treaty. They called it a trade agreement, but it was a treaty, folks. And when they have the disputes, the people who represent them are called treaty lawyers. They can call these things partnerships because they were written by multinational corporations who are partnering to create a global governance run by these multinational corporations, but it's a treaty. And when they created the TPA, the Trade Promotion Authority, what they did was they shut down the constitutional process for ratifying a treaty. And I got to say, every person, Republican and Democrat, who voted for that, all the senators but four voted for that, every one of them voted to violate the Constitution, to simply ignore the Constitution, not to amend the Constitution, just said, we don't care what the Constitution says. We've got a different process. We all agree that we're going to ignore the oath to the Constitution that we took when we took office. Remember earlier I said, you know, the Guardian says, hey, oath keepers assert that when people who are law enforcement officers take an oath to the Constitution, they're taking an oath to the Constitution, not to their political leaders. Clearly, Washington doesn't believe that. The Guardian doesn't believe that, doesn't understand that. The people in Washington think they can do whatever they want. They take an oath to the Constitution and they're done with it. They don't ever have to look at it. They don't have to be bothered with it. They can do whatever they please because they're in charge. Executive orders, or they can just all get together and the majority of these congressmen can say, we're going to ignore the constitutional processes, which is what Paul Ryan did. So yeah, if Trump is elected, the biggest obstacle that he's going to have to getting anything done with the borders, with Obamacare, with the corporate takeover or management of our trade is going to be Paul Ryan. He needs to be primaried out. Get him out of there now. Stay with us. We'll be right back with Michael Schneider. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. We're going to be going to our guest, Michael Schneider, in just a moment. Real quickly, I want to read you a headline from Infowars.com. This has just been put up by Kit Daniels. Republicans for Hillary? Major Cruz donors are shifting to Hillary Clinton. As he points out, one of the donors, Renaissance Technologies, spent over $13 million on Cruz's campaign and is now pouring millions into Clinton's coffers. They say her campaign is signaling to Republican donors that Hillary, quote, represents your values better than Trump, unquote. Yes, she does. She has Wall Street values. She has globalist values. She has international trade agreement values, okay? That's what they wanted to get through this time. They wanted a candidate, and they could get it either with Jeb Bush or Ted Cruz or pretty much any of the candidates except Donald Trump. That's why they said never Trump, because he's the only one out of the 17 that were running that opposed the trade deals. I guess we could put Rand Paul in there as well. I think he opposed those trade deals. He certainly opposed the TPA, the unconstitutional TPA. And he opposed those trade deals, even though he talks about free trade. This is nothing at all like free trade. As Ron Paul's father pointed out, if you want free trade, you don't need thousands of pages of an agreement. That is managed trade. And as Senator Sessions has pointed out, who is now the advisor to Donald Trump, this is trade that is going to be managed by a multinational organization that we don't have any, has no accountability to us. As he pointed out, once these things, the secret trade agreements, the TPP, the TTIP, the transatlantic, the trans-Pacific partnerships, once those are put in place, you are not going to have any control anymore over your economy. It's going to be managed by these people who are offshore. You're going to create a living document that is going to be constantly changed by these people, amended by them. They're going to be setting up all the details without any input from your elected representatives, just as they created this treaty without any input from your elected representatives, because you are not a stakeholder. So now we see the Wall Street stakeholders are now coalescing behind Hillary. Of course they are. Of course they are. That was the plan all along, to have themselves perfectly hedged with either Hillary or a Jeb-like figure. And of course, Ted Cruz qualified for that. He qualified for that. He supports, he wrote with Paul Ryan these trade agreements. So now these donors are coalescing behind Hillary Clinton. Very interesting. Let's go to our guest now. Michael Snyder is the creator of the economiccollapseblog.com, also writes for the end of the American dream.com and the truthwins.com. He is a frequent contributor to infowars.com as well. He does not belong to any political party or any political organization. He believes the coming economic collapse is going to unfold over a number of years. And he tells us about the warning signs that he sees. So joining us now is Michael Snyder. Welcome, Michael.
Thank you for having me on the program. It's really great to be back with you again.
Well, thank you. It's good to talk to you again. I was looking at this article that you just put out a couple of days ago. The next employment crisis is here. Job cuts at U.S. companies jumped 35% in April. What's causing this, Michael?
Well, what's happening, causing this, is an economic slowdown, and we see evidence of this all around us. So we got these new numbers, Challenger Grain Christmas, which does a great job of tracking these things. According to them, the number of job cut announcements at major firms in the United States increased 35% in April, a huge, massive increase. And in fact, and it's just, but it's not just one month. For the first 4 months of 2016, January through April, compared to the same period a year ago, the number of announced job cuts are up 24% overall. So this huge increase, we haven't seen anything like this since the last recession. It's a huge signal that the economy is slowing down, that we're starting to see and we're starting to see this in the employment numbers. And it's hitting many people personally. In fact, in my own extended family, just in the past few months, three people have lost their jobs just in the last few months. Wow. So it's starting. But of course, this is reflective of what's going on in the overall economy. I mean, you look at the GDP numbers. The GDP number for the United States has been in decline for three quarters in a row. For the first quarter of this year, it came in at 0.5%, which is just very, very poor. But you have to keep in mind that a change was made in 2015 specifically to bolster the first quarter numbers, because they said, oh, the first quarter number always comes in too low. We've got to artificially inflate it. So this number that we got, 0.5%, was actually with that artificial inflation that was built in. So without that artificial inflation, it would have very likely been a negative number. But of course, we've seen very poor economic growth all throughout Barack Obama's tenure. In fact, he's on track. This is maybe hard to believe, but he's on track to become the first president ever never to have a year of an entire year of 3% growth for the economy. And he's had, you know, he's going to have 8 years. We're talking about even presidents that only had 4 years. He's on track to be the first president ever to go through his entire presidency never having a year of 3% growth. In fact, when you look at the average economic growth under Barack Obama, he's on track to have the fourth worst in all of U.S. history. Ever since our founding, he's on track to be the fourth worst in terms of average economic growth. So we're really seeing the economy slow down significantly right now.
I got to interrupt you a second here and ask you, how could that be possible? Because we just had Barack Obama speaking at a commencement organization this last weekend saying, in every respect, this country is better than it was in 1983. Was he lying to us through his teeth?
Yeah, he's flat out lying to us. You know, it's completely and totally ridiculous. You know, the Obama administration says, oh, unemployment's just 5%. And but of course, we don't believe him. But you know who else doesn't believe Barack Obama? The Federal Reserve. According to the New York Post, the Federal Reserve has started keeping their own unemployment statistics because they consider what the federal government is telling them to be so unreliable. And according to the Federal Reserve, the unemployment number is actually closer to 6%. But of course, that's not really realistic either. I mean, John Williams of ShadowStats.com, he says that it's up above 22%, the real unemployment number in this nation. And when you add the number of Americans that are officially unemployed to those that are considered to not be in the labor force, you get more than about 102 million Americans that are of working age that do not have a job right now. And so, but it's, you know, not just employment. You look at, for example, total business sales. I mean, businesses selling stuff to people. That those numbers have been declining since the middle of 2014. So almost for two entire years, total business sales have been declining. Or you look at corporate earnings. Corporate earnings now have been falling for four quarters in a row, basically an entire year. Corporations are earning less money. For the first quarter of 2016, corporate profits were down 7.1%. compared to the same period a year ago. So things are slowing down for corporations big time. And then we're seeing more companies go under right now in a major way. For the first quarter of 2016, commercial bankruptcies were up 32% compared to the same period last year. And firms filing for Chapter 11 bankruptcy, it soared 67% compared to the same period a year ago.
So look at JCPenney. That's one of the long-term retail establishments in this country, one of the oldest retail establishment. They're trying to reorganize and cut hours so that they can stay out of bankruptcy. And we've got Hillary Clinton, where they've got a primary in West Virginia, goes to West Virginia and brags about how she's going to shut down coal mines and take coal jobs. I guess she thinks that she's going to continue with the legacy of Barack Obama of unemployment, because that's what she's talking about. It's absolutely amazing to me that she would go someplace like that and say, we're going to take your jobs, but don't worry, we'll put you on the green reservation, and you'll all just be so happy there. They've lost 10,000 jobs, Michael, in the last 5 years in the mining industry of West Virginia, just there alone. And this is what we're seeing everywhere. You point out in your article, we've lost over 100,000 good-paying jobs in the energy industry over the last couple of years. Things are going to get a lot worse because we're not only going to lose jobs, but our power is going to get much more expensive as we move to these new, untried, untrustworthy forms of crony capitalism that they're selling on us. They call it green. The only thing green about it is the money that they're stuffing under the table to the candidates here.
Oh, absolutely. I'm so glad you brought this up, because as you mentioned, we've lost over 100,000 good paying energy jobs since the beginning of last year. Those are the kind of middle class jobs that we need. You know, that in order to have a middle class, you've got to have middle class jobs. So, you know, we're seeing oil companies, dozens of oil companies, of fracking companies are going under or going bankrupt. But and then you mentioned coal, of course. Coal, Barack Obama's pretty much already almost destroyed the coal industry, and it's hitting the rail industry real hard, because of course the rail industry moves around a lot of this coal. And so you look at the rail traffic for the first quarter was down by something like 11% year over year, which is just, we'd never see that outside of a major recession. And so you've got these rail companies are in huge trouble right now. In fact, I just posted an article just recently about how Union Pacific, there's 292 Union Pacific engines that are sitting in the middle of the Arizona desert doing nothing, because they don't have anything to do. They don't have anything to ship. So and I included a picture of this from Google Earth, and you can see it up on the screen of these engines just sitting there. They don't have anything to do, because rail traffic has declined so precipitously. And of course, we're seeing similar numbers with air traffic, with shipment by ground. That, you know, in terms of the real economy, stuff being bought and sold and shipped around the country, it's slowing down dramatically. So I have no idea, with everything we're seeing around us, how anyone can say that the U.S. economy is in good shape.
You know, it's interesting, too, when you show that picture off of your website there, economiccollapseblog.com. Rail traffic depression, 292 Union Pacific engines are sitting in the Arizona desert doing nothing. I remember it was just a couple of months ago, we had an article about the largest shipping container ship ever to be created. And it was the volume of the Empire State Building. And yet this was coming at a time when we've had, it was actually a snapshot. They showed all the shipping containers were at port. Nobody was moving anything because we've seen a massive decline in all this. When we look at the energy industry and the fact that we're having layoffs there, it's because there's no demand. Stay with us. We'll be right back with Michael Snyder. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. We're talking to Michael Snyder of economiccollapseblog.com. I was just looking at one of your articles here, Michael. All of a sudden, fish are dying by the millions all over the planet. You go through talking about all the various articles that have come up. And, of course, you ask, why is this happening? We honestly don't know why it's happening. But it's important to know that it is happening. We got an article from that you referenced in the here. Smithsonian Magazine says, why are the Chilean beaches covered with dead animals? The South American country's beaches are covered with piles of dead sea creatures. Scientists are trying to figure out why. Then you go to China. We have 35 tons of dead fish have piled up in a lake there, one province. And going back to Bolivia, thousands of dead fish have washed up on the shores of a lake in Bolivia. What's going on? I mean, is it some kind of a bacterial outbreak? Is it pollution? Who knows? But here's one idea, folks. If you're not filtering your water, you really need to be taking care of that. I mean, nobody knew in Flint, Michigan, that there was lead in the water until they started seeing the effects in their children. They didn't taste it. They didn't smell it. They didn't see it. But they saw what it was doing to their children. So you don't want to wait until these things start piling up on you. So make sure that you've got a good water filter to help you do that. We always want to have a win-win situation here. We not only do we sell good quality gravity feed filters like the ProPure filters, we're now offering a special. If you get the ProPure Big or the King unit, you can get your choice of a free gift. You can either get, and both of these gifts are $70 values. You can have the first one is a ProPure fruit-infused water pitcher. You can see these on the website. Second one is a ProPure ProMax shower filter. And the idea is that you want to get rid of the stuff that is killing the fish, okay? Or causing mental issues for these children. And, of course, it's not just the lead. They actually pay to put fluoride and has the same effect as lead. And we've got governments all over this country putting in fluoride at levels that Harvard tells us will cause our children to have mental issues, to lose IQ. So they put this stuff in. They tax you to put it in. You need to make sure that you're taking responsibility for your own water, for the purity, whether it is some kind of a bacteria, whether it's pollution, or whether it is deliberate sabotage or incompetence by our government that is controlling the water supply. You need to take care of yourself, and we're offering that now at InfoWarsStore.com. Also, we still have on some of the best-selling InfoWars Select Storable Foods, 30 to 40% off. That's all made in the USA, non-GMO packaging that is the best you'll find anywhere. It will last on the shelf for 25 years. Now, I want to go back and pick up with Michael Snyder again. Also, if you'd like to call in with questions for Michael Snyder about the economy or comments that you've got about the situations that you're going through, I'm going to give out that number here. That's 800-259-9231. Again, that's 800-259-9231. If you'd like to call with comments or questions for Michael Snyder, creator of the economiccollapseblog.com, also endoftheamericandream.com, a frequent contributor here at InfoWars. Michael, we were just talking about what's going on with shipping containers, with railroad engines that are sitting idle, with shipping containers that are sitting idle all across the country. And we know what's happening in the energy business. You point out in your article that we've had 100,000 jobs lost in the energy business. We've seen the price of oil plummet. And it's not because people are turning to green energy sources. It's because there's no demand for that. And so what they're going to do is they're going to give us more expensive energy that will in turn drive the economy even farther down. And of course, one of the best predictors of your quality of life, even of your life expectancy, is to have cheap, affordable energy. They're now working on removing that. And Hillary Clinton is bragging about that in the state where she's running for primary today. She goes last week and brags about how she's going to take their jobs. Your comments, Mike.
Oh, absolutely. And let's keep in mind, this is not just a U.S. phenomenon. This globe, this slowdown that we're witnessing is truly global in scope. In fact, to a certain extent, the U.S. economy is actually doing better than almost everywhere else on the around the rest of the planet right now. For example, let's go down to South America, you know, where you look at Brazil. Brazil is the seventh largest economy in the entire world. And their economy has been shrinking now for several quarters in a row. And it's been getting worse and worse and worse. This last quarter was the worst. In terms of it's a you know, Goldman Sachs around the turn of the year referred to it as a depression. But just here recently, CNN ran an article that was with this title, Brazil, economic collapse worse than feared. So CNN is using the term economic collapse to describe what is going on down in Brazil right now.
And it's interesting, I think, Michael, to point out that there – economic collapse was preceded by a leftist move in politics. We've now got this lady who is the who was reelected in 2014. There was a lot of talk about how corrupt that election was. They tried to impeach her. They passed a vote in the lower house, and then the Speaker of the House just says, well, I'm going to annul that. That's the kind of dictatorship that we're getting very close to here in the United States, and people need to be aware of that. Stay with us. We'll be right back with Michael Snyder. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're talking to Michael Snyder of the economiccollapseblog.com. We're going to take some of your calls in just a moment. As we went to break, we were talking about the economic collapse of Brazil. Michael brought that up. And, you know, Michael, when I saw this information, I guess it was a couple of, I guess it was about a month now that we had the GOP primary. And I first started looking at this president in Brazil because I was looking at the voting machines that the GOP was using. They'd paid $80,000 to use these Smartmatic voting machines. These are machines that it's the most common of the electronic voting machines, I understand. But this is a company that was started in Hugo Chavez's Venezuela, and they were accused of rigging elections not only in Brazil, where this lady is from, but also in places like the Philippines and Mexico's Tabasco region. Many other places, they have questioned the results of these electronic elections. And here we have a situation where there was massive economic corruption, massive decline in the country under her socialist policies. But it was the corruption that they were coming after her for. They voted to impeach the Brazilian president. And then you've got the Speaker of the House coming in and annulling it. And as I was saying, as we went to break, people say, well, that can't happen here in America. And yet we've had our current speaker and our House and our Senate majority leader go in and annul the constitutional process for ratifying treaties. They did that right in front of our faces with the TPA, and they didn't even blush when they did it. And so when people think that something like this can happen in the United States, certainly it can. And this kind of political corruption that we see in Brazil, that we've seen in Venezuela and elsewhere, that always precedes an economic collapse as well. Your comments.
Agree with you. And of course, the political corruption in this country is getting worse. And the closer Donald Trump gets to the White House, the more desperate the elite are going to become, and the more extreme the measures they're going to take to try to prevent that. So I think that's something to look forward moving forward. But in terms of socialism, you mentioned, you know, if you want to see the end game of socialism, just look at what's happening in Venezuela right now.
That's right.
Where they complete and total economic collapse in Venezuela. You've got inflation of more than 500%. So people actually get some money. You know, if they actually have a job and they get some money, they race to the stores to buy something before the prices go up tomorrow or the next week. It's kind of like, you know, the Weimar Republic from the 1930s, what's going on in Venezuela. So in Venezuela, you've got stores that are basically entirely empty. You've got shortages of food, shortages of basic supplies. And it's really kind of devolving into a Mad Max situation where the gangs are just running wild. The mafia is taking control, and where, you know, basically basic government functions, the police power, everything is just breaking down, and where they're shutting down the country. They're telling people not to work on certain days because it's just basically full-blown economic collapse in Venezuela. But it's the end result of their radical socialist policies that they've been pursuing for years.
I covered this a little bit yesterday on the fourth hour, and I thought it was interesting, Michael, that the solutions that these guys are coming up with are the same solutions we're seeing from Obama, from Hillary, from Bernie. They're saying things like, well, you know, they're giving them subsidized, nearly free energy. We pay 10 cents a kilowatt hour here. They're paying 1.5 cents there for the residential stuff. They're raising the minimum wage. They're giving them green energy, and they're rationing everything. And at the same time, we see that Wall Street has been bragging for a couple of years about what a great return on investment they got from Hugo Chavez and from his successor, saying they get 700% return on their investment because they may be socialists, but they realize that Wall Street comes before their people. Their people may have to beg, borrow, or steal, or go to another country to get food, water, medicine, but these bankers are going to get their money first. That's why we see them now coalescing behind Hillary Clinton, because she's going to offer, along with Barack Obama, the same kind of socialist policies that are going to destroy their economy, make them dependent. But the Wall Street will get paid even though they have free stuff that they can't provide. That's the amazing thing. Let's go to one of our callers here. Let's go to Dan in New Mexico. Dan, you got a comment or a question for Michael Snyder?
Yeah, I've got two questions, actually, and I'll go ahead and try and state them as quickly and precisely as possible, and kind of one question for you, Dave. I'm curious what you see in the data, Michael, about people who happen to be in my particular category and the way that we participate in the economy and what sort of insight that might show you. And in my situation, I was, after 30 plus years corporate America, age of 58, got laid off, outsourced to China, took about 2 months of unemployment, and then I said, you know, I'm just going to do it on my own. And I basically run an LLC out of my bedroom here, just a one-man kind of show. Don't take any support or any subsistence and just do it all on my own. And so I'm kind of curious. My feeling is that that's a big trend in the economy. I don't know what you might be seeing. And then my second question would be, you know, kind of for the both of you, and Dave, I think more for you, is I keep telling some of my more conservative friends that Trump's a pretty smart guy, and that after he gets nominated and we start moving closer towards the election, that he's going to take more of a liberty stance, and it's just an intuition. And I'm kind of wondering what your input is on that. Thank you.
Well, let's take the question to Michael Snyder first. Michael, he's asking about people who get laid off later in their working career, and they take that experience and they start a new job of their own. Is that a significant trend that you see?
Yeah, I'm seeing a number of people try to do this. Unfortunately, on a broader scale, society as a whole, the rate of self-employment in the United States is hovering near all-time record lows, been declining throughout the Obama administration because they make it so hard. So, you know, America was built on entrepreneurship, on small businesses. But today, because of all the red tape, literally we have millions of laws and rules and regulations when you add in state and local and federal, red tape. And so it's so hard. And then, of course, if you're self-employed, they hit you with both halves of they call it the self-employment tax, where, you know, instead of just, you know, the part of the Social Security, you have to pay both halves of the Social Security, everything else. So they tax you to death when you try to go on your own. They hit you with all this red tape, and they make it exceedingly difficult. And so it can be very, very hard, very, very challenging. But that's what America was built on, unfortunately, because of, you know, with socialism, they want to centralize everything. They want to get, you know, the big corporations in control of everything, because big government and big corporations work very, very well together. That's why our founding fathers were so suspicious of both big government and any large concentrations of power, such as big corporations. They really limited the size and scope of corporations in early America. But today, big government and big corporations run everything. And the little guy who tries to, you know, set up his own business, do his own thing, is very, very hard to compete against the corporations. Then they tax you to death and they strangle you with red tape. So it's very, yeah, very hard.
Yeah. I would second that. I would say that, you know, both my grandparents and my father, both my grandfathers and my father were in business for themselves. And I look back at the businesses that they were in, they would not be allowed to operate today by federal regulations. It's the federal government that has come in and shut down so many different opportunities. And when they start shutting down small businesses, and one of the businesses that we had, we were selling to other small businesses. And as we saw them falling off and falling by the wayside, it started to hurt our bottom line as well. So that's it's kind of a cascading domino effect, because we're not going to sell a lot to the big corporations. They're going to be buying from China. So when we've got a Main Street economy here, where we got small businesses who are buying and selling services or goods to each other, as some of them start to get squeezed out by the big companies that are doing business in China, or they get shut down by federal regulation, then your market starts to slip as well. And when you're talking, and the other question you had, Dan, about whether or not Trump is going to move towards liberty, I don't know. We'll just have to wait and see. We're going to push him as hard as we can towards individual liberty, because as Alex has said, you can't make America great unless you make America free. The first thing that we should be looking for, even above our economic issues, and I know that this is not practical. I know the thing that motivates people to get involved is going to be economic suffering, but we have to understand that we're not going to have any economic prosperity if they shut down our individual liberty, if they take the rule of law away from us, if they take away our Bill of Rights. We are not going to have a economically prosperous country. We're not going to have a free country either. It's going to impact our security, our safety as well. We've got Alex Jones on the line here, ready to come in. Alex, welcome.
David, it's good to be here with you today. I appreciate you sitting in. I got an eye infection, I guess, overnight. I've actually gone to see the doctor, and I can't find an infection. It looks like I've got a scratch on the inside of my eye. It should heal in a couple days, but I'm taking care of some business while that's going on, just in case folks wonder why I only have one eye open. The writing of Michael Schneider, the analysis of the other economists and experts we have on, it's very, very clear that most of the world is already in a collapse event. And it's an orchestrated collapse to bring in the world government, to bring in the world cashless society. And they're preparing everyone to get rid of cash now. They're preparing everyone to get rid of borders. They are just brazenly throwing the entire agenda in everyone's face. So the question is a collapse coming? No, there is a global collapse already happening. It's just not equally distributed right now. And that's really the main focus that I'm trying to laser beam in on, is that the globalists admit they have organized crises. They admit they have organized collapses at a nation-by-nation level. So the central banks can come in and, quote, buy them out for pennies on the dollar, give their corrupt leaders loans that they never pay off. Case point example is Nigeria borrows a couple billion dollars in the 60s, and they've paid over $100 billion today on the $3 billion. And there's many other examples of that going on. So that's what this domestication is all about. But meanwhile, while you're having the collapse, you want to divert the public and act like you're the saviors to get more banker bailouts, more power, more control. In fact, the bankers just don't go in and set up and engineer systems where countries collapse economically and they come in and take over. The bankers go through their private subsidiaries, have one of them go bankrupt like Lehman Brothers, have the stock market go down by 35%, scaremonger everybody and say, okay, we'll sign on to unlimited trillions in debt to your private system. And then once we're signed on to the debt of the mega banks, 2.2 quadrillion, last time they released numbers in the Wall Street Journal and USA Today 5 years ago, it's much bigger derivatives overhang now. We're signed on to over $2,000 trillion. So we're debating this $19 trillion national debt. That's what we really owe. If you look at expenditures and guarantees and things that are obligations, it's more like $100 trillion. But still, our total debt's $100 trillion that you could argue that we were maneuvered into in this domesticated society. But we've been signed on to 2.2 quadrillion. So it's the public's ignorance about how things really work that is allowing the social engineers to carry out these operations. That's why it's so important to get the word out, and why Donald Trump talking about globalism's the problem, unfair trade deals are the problem, politicians selling us out. He says because they're stupid. No, they're not stupid. Most of them are retiring overseas with the billions they've made by setting up laws that moved our jobs to China, Mexico, India, and other third world countries. And they make deals with the corrupt governments who are command and control. That's why the CIA admitted back in the 60s they want fascism, communism, socialism, oligarchy. They don't care. Carol Quigley wrote about it in Tragedy and Hope. They want a top-down system, so they're only working with a few people at the top who they can go multinationally, make deals with to basically have slave labor, i.e. Foxconn and Apple Laboratories, with the suicide nets, forced abortion, and 17-hour work days, no pensions, no environmental standards, and a 35% tariff on currency, impossible for us to compete. This is how you bring America to its knees. It's how you bring Europe to its knees. This is how they've got us in checkmate. Then they bring in a, quote, service economy. They bring in social engineering when the economy won't survive, where you sign on to a government job or corporate welfare or other systems where you're dependent and now you're part of the hive Borg. Independence has been neutralized. But to make sure the youth are so brain scrambled that they never figure out that they were induced into college degrees that were worthless 90% of the time, to realize that they were being set up for a post-industrial technocracy, you just brainwash them with total political correctness, where you actually say in public, let's go eat Mexican food, and people look at you and say, you're racist, you shouldn't have done that. I actually today, was talking about Mexican food and had someone say, that's racist. And I said, are you joking? Someone walking by me, and they said, no. So this is the total mental illness where words and language and numbers can just like voodoo be told to be evil, and to create a new superstition where everyone just runs around hamstrung, rolling in a fetal position, metaphysically urinating on themselves. I mean, this is just out of control. And there's articles on Infowars.com that dovetail with this. UVA student identifying as American is microaggression. Safe space are having, quote, shut down and our appropriation of the entire hemisphere. That's just like all over the United States. People that wear American flags on their shirts in public schools and colleges are being kicked out, even though they're Hispanic, because the illegals who've been brought in, who are totally nationalistic, in many cases very racist, a lot of them are great people, but a lot of them, the more thuggish and, you know, trashy they are, and every group's got their trash. You know, white trash tends to be Klan, Mexican trash tends to be La Raza Mecha, and the Klan will intimidate whites to join them. Mecha La Raza will intimidate Hispanics join them. And then they get them into these groups. But here you have the colleges and the media pushing it, and major comedians pushing it. So it's okay. So now you can't even see an American flag. People laugh at that. The UK is starting to take down its main national flag, the flag of the empire. They're also basically banned the King George flag, the original flag of England, you know, white with a red cross on it. That actually happened. So this is what the globalists are doing, is this world corporate Borg is conquering everything, conquering culture, conquering mathematics, conquering, they're at war with reality, like Winston Smith's told by O'Brien in 1984, when he's in the torture center, amply named the Ministry of Love, he's told, hey, don't worry. You know, we could have our mathematicians suspend gravity if we wanted to. And even though you wouldn't be floating in the air, you would believe that you're floating in the air because we control reality, and I will torture you and brainwash you until you believe it. Winston says, no, 2 + 2 = 4. And he says, no, in the end, buddy, you won't be able to know what 2 + 2 =. And then when you're done, we're going to burn your body up and shoot you into the atmosphere. And you never would have existed. You'll be erased out of everything. And that's what Facebook and everybody else does. I mean, this is true scientific tyranny, the elite going for all the marbles. The brass ring is life extension, merging with machines, they believe, and living forever and being gods. I'm not saying that's what's going to happen. I'm saying from my own books and films I've made with their own quotes, that's their in-game goal. And, of course, I made Endgame 8 years ago, 9 years ago. The media made fun of it. Now everything in Endgame is kind of in your face, out in the open. And it's just an amazing time to be alive. So when we come back, I'll continue this discussion with you guys for two more sections. Bring in David, bring in Mr. Schneider and more. But that's why it's more important than ever to spread the word about Infowars.com and other alternative news sites that are telling the truth. Is we're in a human war against the rigged technocracy. And humans can use computers and technology that we rewire and re-equip to get around their algorithms by always changing and always resisting. They count on us being pliant serfs, pliant cattle, lying down. But if we're aware of the enemy operations, resisting it like weightlifting or mountain climbing only makes us stronger. This is the battle for the human species on this planetoid orbiting a standard sun 2/3 of the way out of the Milky Way galaxy. It's an epic fight. You're part of it. We're going to the stars. Let's break the eugenicists and go to the next level. Stay with us as they accelerate their global collapse to capture humanity and bring us into submission. You're listening to The Alex Jones Show. I'm Alex Jones. Wild horses couldn't drag me away. David Knight is honchoing the broadcast. I'll be gone in about 10 minutes. Michael Steiner's with us 5 minutes in the next hour. I know they've got another very informative guest coming up here on the transmission today. I was mentioning this article on Infowars.com. UVA student identifying as American is a microaggression. And I talked about 2 years ago being at with my children at Barton Springs on a very sunny summer day. And there were people frolicking around, two white guys and a Hispanic guy. And they said, man, this is really fun, blah, blah, blah. hey, let's go get some Chinese food. Because the guy's like 10 feet away yelling, hey, let's get some Chinese food. And the two friends go, that's racist. And they weren't joking. I mean, because there's no language now. Just saying, hey, well, let's go get, let's go to Russian House in Austin, Texas. I've never been there, but here it's good food. And they're like, oh, you said Russian. Or, hey, let's go get some Mexican food. Oh, my God, Mexican food, you know. Just even identifying male or female as being banned, he or she, it's hurtful. You had language. You made me upset. And then it's all, oh, my gosh, this is very, very, very serious. It's mind control. It's bullying. It's completely out of control. Now, I've got another article that's up here on Infowars.com that deals with this. Court orders dad to start treating his 11-year-old daughter as a boy. The father not only wants his daughter to cease taking hormone blockers, but also to cease all contact with transgender activists or transgender-friendly therapists. What's happening is you send your kid to therapy at the school, or now they're doing it in the kindergarten, Obama's announced. It was in Politico 2 days ago. And then the government comes and says, you might be a boy, you might be a girl, you might be a nothing, you might be a trans species, you might be a dog. You might be, you know, you're a 5.5 foot tall, let's say, black woman. No, you're really a 6'7" Chinese man. This is just all the, because you don't get privacy or freedom or rights anymore. That's all gone. But you get to be an Easter bunny, or you get to have taxpayers pay for your abortion, or to have your, tallywhacker cut off. I mean, this is the stuff that's going on in this country and in this world. The reason I dovetail this with all the engineered collapse news is they're not just collapsing the economy, but the society, the culture, and it's in their textbooks. It's in their admissions. It doesn't mean I hate someone because they're female and they like women. Or it doesn't mean I hate someone because they're a man, they're attracted to men. That's always gone on. Some of that's in history. Whatever. They're just people. The point is that they just take culture that isn't inducive of the overall species and force jacket into everything. And now they're coming after the cash. Now they're coming after the Amish and the farmers markets and the local bartering and the swap meets. They're going after normal human activity because they want to socially engineer us. The globalists see us as wild humans running around eating up the earth. The globalists have stolen by fraud, which they believe belongs to them. The truth is they're farming our intelligence. They're farming our technologies. They're parasites. But now they don't need us because of the age of computers and robots. And you can argue there's too many people in some areas, and we are destructive. The point is there's a giant breakaway civilization that's taken away those decisions and is also not doing good things in the environment. The globalists are the most destructive with their open-air chemtrailing and their geoengineering and their biological and chemical testing and their cross-species garbage everywhere. And so I've analyzed them, folks. And if there isn't a devil, there is now. Ray Kurzweil always says, I don't believe in God yet. I'm going to become God. This is profound. Ray Kurzweil says, I don't believe in God yet. I'm going to become God. Well, let me tell you something. If you were an atheist, you didn't believe in the devil before, and I could have questioned it, 20, 30 years ago myself. You look at this and pull back, man. It's like a satanic spirit, a hive mind, whatever you want to call it. These people are the perfect description of Satan of the Bible, of all the aspects of it. And I'm telling you, they come to kill, steal, and destroy. Michael Steiner, David Knight. I know we're going to break. What are we going to cover in the next segment, Steiner?
Well, we can talk about the secret meeting that was just held in New York where globalists are taking things to the next level, where they're introducing digital cash, where before we could transfer money out of our bank account and it would end up in another bank account. But now they're actually going to digitize cash, make cash into the digits.
Exactly, which I've always warned is coming next, and it still makes it digital. All of it to be tracked. Great point. Tracking cash. They're moving, folks. They're moving on every front. Stay with us. We're doing a Facebook mentions while we do this live show, and Buckley, my cousin here running this, over at Buckley's house, Norton Buckley's house, is holding the headphones up so you can actually hear the intro. I'm going to turn this over to Schneider and David Knight right now, but Schneider brings up they're bringing in digital cash where it tracks its whole history from the mint to the bank to you, where it went. This is the global control. And some will say, well, that's good. They'll stop criminals. It's the big banks launder the money. They exempt themselves from all this. Okay, this is to shut down barter economies. This is to bring in total control for social engineering. And, oh, you'll get your welfare check. You got to take vaccines. Or you can keep your job, but the TSA has to approve it. And by the way, we caught you, getting some cash that wasn't yours. You get a digital bill. It's beyond license plate readers and things like that. So, folks, I'd always warn people about this 20 years ago, and they'd say, oh, there's no license plate readers. Now you know about it. Or I'd warn you about the new tech going in cars to tax you by the mile. People said, oh, that doesn't exist, and now it's ubiquitous. What he was just talking about with the digital cash is what I've always warned you of, and it's here. It's how they get rid of cash. And it's a very serious, serious situation. It's about total total control. And that's why we've got to vote with our dollars now, because they're bringing in an actuaried system, an algorithm, where they're going to selectively tax and enforce with fines and fees and things against any independent system to where you can't operate. This is a total takeover that would make the Nazis just, you know, absolutely have a dream. You don't count a dream. This is something that authoritarians have dreamed of. It's here. It's called smart systems. It's called Agenda 21. So, Mr. Schneider, you and David Knight take over. But, folks, buy our products, buy our videos, the Hillary for Prison shirt. We've got the new special out with 40% off of storable food on the four best sellers. Had to end the special on all of it, but those are the four best sellers. And know that we're going against the wind, against the enemy, but we're having victories. Thanks for your prayers and your support. Guys, please continue. God bless you.
Thank you, Alex. I hope you're feeling better. Get well soon. We need you back here. Let's go to Michael. You were talking about just, you mentioned it to Alex, this article you just had about the meeting. And, of course, we've seen this covered. Bloomberg actually covered this. This is not something that you're breaking. This is mainstream news. Tell us about this secret meeting where they're working on a new kind of blockchain that will allow them to control this without anonymity.
Yeah, is this company, the name of the company is actually Chain, which seems quite appropriate, as in the chains of our enslavement, but it was held right in Times Square, this meeting, and this new digital currency, which isn't tied to your bank account at all. The digits are actually the currency, the dollars, and the idea is that we're going to go entirely away from paper currency and to this digital dollars, and it's going to replace Bitcoin, it's going to replace all these things, but of course, it's going to be controlled by the bankers, by the elite. And so at this secret meeting in New York, which was covered by Bloomberg, there were more than 100 prominent Wall Street banking executives there. People like Citigroup, other major financial companies were there. And this new technology was unveiled for them kind of in secret because, you know, they don't want to alarm the general public because, of course, the general public's not in favor of a cashless society. But we're seeing this happen all over the world where, for example, in Sweden, the ATMs are being pulled out by the hundreds. And almost everything is cashless at this point. They're even handing out cashless readers to the homeless people on the street so they can take their donations or they can sell their newspapers and they can have people, you know, swipe their card or whatever. You know, in Denmark, the official policy of the government is to eradicate cash by the year 2030. In Norway, the biggest bank in Norway has come out and called on the government there to completely eliminate all cash, even though Norway is almost completely cashless at this point. Or we see other countries in Europe where they're setting caps on how much cash you can use, you know, whether it's 1,000 euros, 2,500 euros. It varies from country to country where they're slowly outlawing cash by saying, okay, you can use cash, but only up to a certain amount. And of course, now they're moving to get rid of the 500 euro note completely. You know, but we're seeing these movements toward a cashless society all over the world. And governments really are excited about this idea because they can watch and track and monitor everything we do. Our financial privacy will be essentially gone.
That's right. They're selling it as a way of cutting down on criminal activity. And that's the way they're selling it in Sweden. There's a story that we're going to cover later in the show out of Wired Magazine about how one Swede will kill cash forever. Thank you so much, Michael Schneider. Stay with us. We're going to be talking to a bank whistleblower when we come right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host. We're going to be going to a bank whistleblower, from HSBC, John Cruz, in just a moment. I want to tell the people who are holding to talk. If you can hang on long enough, I'll get to you at the bottom of the hour. I apologize, we haven't been able to get to you yet, but I'll take your calls later in the show if you can hang on. As we've talked about in the past, we've interviewed one other whistleblower from HSBC, and as I think one of the best articles I've seen on this was a very in-depth article from Matt Taibbi, I think is the way you pronounce his name, the writer for Rolling Stones, talking about how gangster bankers are too big to jail. He broke it down. He broke down the history of HSBC, pointing out it is, of course, the Hong Kong Shanghai Bank. It got its start during drug wars, okay? It's not the drug wars of the 1800s. This was associated in 1865. They were associated with the opium wars that were going on there within the British Empire. As Everett Stern pointed out, he was part of the group that was hired the first time HSBC was convicted of money laundering to drug cartels, to foreign terrorists. And he pointed out a number of ways that they skirted that issue. We have joining us now John Cruz, who is also a whistleblower. And his testimony And, of course, this has been followed quite a bit by Jerome Corsi. He's done a lot of interviews with John Cruise. And to introduce the subject, we're going to play an excerpt from an interview that Jerome Corsi had. But he blew the whistle on what was going on at HSBC, sent information to Loretta Lynch, who is now our attorney general. She never called him back. She admitted that she had the information, and she never did anything with it. And it became part of the confirmation hearings for Loretta Lynch. And then we found out after she became attorney general that she let these guys get away with bank robbery again, because it is bank robbery when the banks rob us. Let's play a clip of the interview with Jerome Corsi and John Cruise.
I was the vice president, senior business relationship manager. Job involved helping businesses manage their business life, manage their finances, manage their trade, manage transactions, wire transfers, checking accounts.
And John, you have written a book. Can you show us the book?
World Banking, World Fraud, Using Your Identity.
Great. Thank you. And, okay, so you recognize that these are papers that you provided me?
Yes.
So these are papers that you pulled out of the bank's computer system, is that correct?
These are right straight from the bank's computer system.
And you pulled these because you suspected they were fraudulent transactions, is that correct?
I pulled these because I thought there were suspicious activities taking place, and these same documents I brought to senior security within the bank.
Now, John, you realize what you're saying is that bank employees, including bank security officers and fairly senior officers of the bank, are involved then in a pattern of illegal activity. Is that
That's correct. That's what I'm saying, and that's what I've also recorded in my voice recorders during meetings with managers, with senior security. I have hours upon hours of voice recordings.
All right, now you can see the rest of that report at his website. That's worldbankingworldfraud.com. It's just a sample of that. And, of course, John Cruise has been a vice president, a senior business relations manager for HSBC. He blew the whistle on criminal money laundering, and yet, of course, as we've seen multiple times now, with not only HSBC, but with many other... Your testimony figured in prominently in the confirmation hearings of Loretta Lynch, who replaced Eric Holder as Attorney General. And, of course, we'd seen the Holder administration of the Department of Justice give a wrist slap to HSBC and others, and then people questioned her on the information that you gave, that Jerome Corsi published at WND. And then this became part of our confirmation hearing. When she was confirmed as Attorney General, the very first thing she did, and this is a report from Corsi at WND, the very first major action she did as Attorney General was to allow five big banks, Citibank, JP Morgan, Chase, Barclays, Royal Bank of Scotland, and UBS, to plead guilty to felony charges for manipulating the foreign exchange currency markets. That's called Forex, for those of you who do this on a regular basis, and pay $6 billion in fines. Now, that may sound like a lot of money to people, but to put that in perspective, Corsi points out that the Bank of International Settlement estimated the market is averaging $5.3 trillion in trading per day in April of 2013. So, to put this in perspective, let's say that you go in and you rob a bank, and you get $1 million, and they catch you, and you get a fine of $1,000. Are you going to keep doing it? Of course you're going to keep doing it. Yes. And these banks keep doing it, and it gets even worse than that, because it's like you were robbing people for $1 million per day, and you get a one-time fee of $1,000. Of course they're going to keep doing this. John, tell us what you saw there as a bank manager that you were blowing the whistle on.
What I saw is I saw many transactions taking place around the world. The bank was conducting the transactions using the public's identity, using their social security numbers, using their tax IDs for their corporations, and laundering money around the world for drugs, for terrorists, for paying off politicians. It's just trillions and trillions of dollars. Never mind billions, it's trillions of dollars. Whenever you've seen launch transactions, 100,000, a million, 10 million, 800 million. You're supposed to file suspicious activity reports to confirm these transactions. Mm-hmm. The bank would never file the suspicious activity reports when I reported to them, the executives. The executives would leave the accounts open. They say, yes, there are no entities to these accounts, but leave them open. They're not doing nothing with them. They make money off these accounts.
Yeah. Yeah, and of course we saw a similar thing happen when I talked to Everett Stern. He was in the money laundering division that they created after they were caught the first time, and he said there were key terms that they had in their database that would flag certain types of transactions out of these suspicious activities reports. And he noticed that, as you know, these things were not getting flagged, and he looked at the database and there would be like a space inserted in the name or a period inserted to the name. So it was something that was very deliberate. They didn't want it to get flagged by the software. And now you're telling us that even when it was flagged, because it was such a large transaction, they would just pass this through.
That is correct. But the idea was, is they're using the public's identity on their escrow accounts. They create accounts that are called unidentified in their checking accounts, so they do not report them to the IRS. Mm. They use them to transfer money. They'll keep them open for 30 days, transfer all the money around the world, what they want to transfer in that account, and then close it the day before it was opened. Wow. To eliminate the transactions once the money has passed.
Wow. And of course, it occurs to me that when we see the massive open borders in this country and the people who are coming in, and that gives them a very plausible deniability for all of this, because they can say, hey, this is just somebody who came in, they're undocumented, so we create these bogus accounts and everything. But you're pointing out it goes even beyond that. I mean, that's a very that's a very plausible thing for them to be able to hide this money deliberately. But then they go in and they even delete these accounts prior to their creation date, so they disappear completely, just flush Correct. Them down the memory hole.
Yes. Wow. This is what they do. This is how they wipe out transactions. Once the money is done, the crime is committed, they eliminate the evidence.
You know, I find that interesting because as we were just talking to Michael Schneider about the meeting that was held recently with all these major banks talking about how they want to move to digital cash. We're going to talk about this later in the program, an article from Wired Magazine about how a former band member from ABBA is trying to sell this in Sweden. And of course, he's got a lot of street creds, I guess, in Sweden still. I'm not a big ABBA fan, but there's a lot of people in Sweden, I guess, still are. But he's trying to portray this as cash being something that is strictly the black market. But what you're pointing out here is that this was all done electronically, and it becomes even more easy for criminals, especially the ones in the banks, to hide and to launder money if we have a cashless society, doesn't it?
Yes, it does. It's totally correct. And the criminals own HSBC Bank.
Now, tell us what happened with your whistleblowing to Loretta Lynch, because we've had a whole series of articles that Jerome Corsi did about how you contacted her. She never replied any of this response. And then you gave this information to senators, and they brought it up to her again at the confirmation hearing. Tell us a little bit about that chronology.
Well, sending everything over to the Department of Justice, went over to Eric Holder. It went to Eric Holder, and it went to Loretta Lynch. Both did nothing, refused to do anything. Now, I have documented and recorded conversations with law enforcement, with Congress officials, Senate Judiciary Committee, and as you see on my website, World Bank and World Fraud, there is a CD now with those recordings on it to the world so they can listen to what's going on. But wow. they did nothing, and they are actually, it feels like they're part of the crime of what's going on, even with voice recordings of executives at the bank saying, we pay off government officials.
Yeah, absolutely. They're part of it. Absolutely. And that's a key part that we all need to understand. But it's important that we get this information out in the public. I mean, we can see for the longest time, you know, that when they give them these small wrist slaps, when they ignore this, and as I point out, they can allow these people to rig $1 trillion markets. They can allow them to launder money to drug cartels and to terrorists. And yet Loretta Lynch gets all upset about the bathroom laws in North Carolina. That's what she's focused on. She's not going to focus on the real crime. And of course, we have to lose all of our Bill of Rights. We have to lose all of our privacy for these same people that they tell us are the security threats, that are the danger to us, the drug cartels, the terrorists. And yet they are the ones who are financing and giving them that money. Now, besides seeing the bank accounts that they are establishing, transferring the money, and then disappearing that money, tell us what else you saw there as a whistleblower. Well, hang on. We got to take a quick break, and we're going to come right back. I didn't realize we're that close to the break. We're talking to John Cruz. He is a whistleblower who used to work for HSBC, and his website is worldbankingworldfraud.com. You can see the conversations that he recorded with law enforcement there, as well as find the book that he recorded all this. We'll be right back with more information from John Cruz. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're talking to a whistleblower from HSBC, John Cruz. His testimony was given to senators. It was first ignored by the Department of Justice. They questioned Loretta Lynch during her confirmation hearings, and she basically blew that off. And as it says on his bio here, John Cruz had two choices while he was working for the bank. He could either commit willful blindness, he could break federal law violating the Bank Secrecy Act, or he could refuse to be a part of the money laundering scheme and get fired. He chose the latter, and you can read about his episodes at worldbankingworldfraud.com. And as he pointed out in the last segment, he has recorded conversations with law enforcement and others. It's very important for us to understand the depth of corruption that is involved not only in this administration, but in previous administrations as well. You have to understand this is not simply an Obama administration problem. It is on steroids with the Obama administration. And we've seen them catch these bankers red-handed and give them a slap on their wrist and let them go without any serious penalties. We have to understand that what is feeding all of this is the war on drugs and the war on terror. It was created by the banks so they could make money, and it creates power for the government. And it's very important for us to understand what the whistleblowers, to listen to these whistleblowers, understand what they're telling us, and take it very seriously. Mr. Cruz, tell us again what you think we should take away from this. What are your concerns for society in terms of how do we correct this? How do we do something about this?
My opinion, we need to vote out the individuals that are in office, the corrupt individuals. They need to go. We need people in office, new, fresh, that are here for the American people. We do not need people in office collecting money from lobbyists, through money laundering, through terrorists, through drugs. I mean, no presidential campaign should be allowed to collect money from a terrorist organization whatsoever. It's totally illegal.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree. Now, when you were blowing the whistle on this, did you find, of course, we know that you got shut down at the highest levels from Loretta Lynch, then from the Department of Justice. Did you find people at lower levels that wanted to expose this or wanted to work with you, or did you get shut down at that level as well?
I got shut down at every level I went to. This is a high industry of money that's going around the world, and everyone's involved to make money. That's the way it's all created. That's how the bank makes it. So more money that transfers, the more money the employees make, the more money that Congress makes, the more money law enforcement makes off of it. It goes around and around. It's a huge circle.
Wow. And that's not a surprise either, because we look at civil asset forfeiture, this legal fiction by which they charge inanimate objects and just take your property without charging you with a crime. And we see the federal government is training local and state law enforcement to be partners in crime with them, to turn into literal highway robbers saying, hey, we'll give you a cut of all this. And as people started to expose these abuses, as we started to see things at the state level, reforms being enacted by state legislators, we saw the Obama administration, the Department of Justice, kind of back down and say, well, we're going to pull back from some of this. We're not going to share this revenue with them to incentivize them. Then it kind of died down, and now they have quietly reasserted the fact that they are now going to partner with these law enforcement agencies to give them a percentage of the money they steal from people on the highway. That's what we're seeing there. So it doesn't surprise me that you would find this at every single level, an indifference to the corruption.
That is correct. Where is the money going? I mean, I have conversations on my recordings on World Bank and World Fraud that the Republican Party doesn't even know where the $1.9 billion that was collected from HSBC by the Obama administration directed under Loretta Lynch. No one knows where the money is in the Republican Party.
Yeah, and they don't care either, because they want to be, they've been a part of this game in the past and they want to be a part of it in the future. You would think that they would be pushing on this like they pushed on Benghazi or some other issues. And they don't bring those issues to a conclusion either. But you would think that they would push on this, but they want to keep this whole scam going. I think one of the things people don't realize either is that these issues at the bottom of this, again, the drug issues, the drug cartels, this is something that was created by the United Nations. You would expect that the Republicans would be concerned about this war on drugs. That was a UN creation. They created the schedules. They even populated it with the drugs 10 years before Richard Nixon got in there. Is there any place in the world that you've seen the governments that are interested in trying to crack down on these banks, or are all the governments co-opted, in your opinion?
My opinion, all the officials high up are all corrupt. There are certain individuals in government that are not corrupt that we'd like to change, but they're outnumbered.
Yeah, that seems to be the case everywhere we look, isn't it? Tell people how they can find out more information about your whistleblowing activities and see the documents that you've got.
Well, the documents, the voice recordings are all worldbankingworldfraud.com. You can get a copy of the CD, get a copy of the book. It's all there. These are actual live uncut recordings. Individual names are there, the actual conversations, everything that's going on within the bank, within our world, within our government.
Thank you so much for doing that. It's very, very important for people to see for themselves the corruption that you're telling us about. Thank you for doing that. Thank you for documenting it. It's one way that we have to wake up, and you have to wake up your neighbors to this. Stay with us. We'll be right back with your phone calls. Thank you so much, John Cruz. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm going to go to our callers, many of whom have been holding since we were talking to Michael Schneider in just a moment. Before we do, I've been promoting this Bill Corrigan report that we had. He was here with an interview for Alex Jones, if you remember. But we had another interview that you haven't seen yet. It was done in our newly remodeled studio that we have for the InfoWars Nightly News. Leanne McAdoo did it. We're going to be premiering this on Wednesday on the Alex Jones Show. It's going to be a 30-minute interview. And we wanted to give you a little bit of a trailer that we shot with Bill Corrigan. He fleshes out the social justice warrior movement, as they put it here. Why is it happening? How will it end? Here's a trailer for this interview that's coming up.
Premiering this week on the Alex Jones Show.
I was propagandized as a kid to believe that everything America did was great.
For news is ready-made propaganda.
The world is a vampire.
And like a lot of people, as I got into the world in the 70s and 80s, I realized that wasn't true. But I do believe America is better than any other political and social system that's ever been created in the world. So I don't care what your trendy argument, I don't care what your hashtag argument is. If you do not stand for free speech, you do not stand for America. That means you want something else. And if you think your something else is going to be better than America, I'm here to tell you you're wrong. Can't believe we're even having this discussion, if you can understand why I say that to you humbly. To be talking in America about, in 2016, you know, about Mao's a good idea and a socialist is running for president and that's okay. I mean, that's just crazy to me. You know, obviously I listen to you and I listen to Alex and I listen to David Knight and Jakari. I mean, you guys do a fine job of identifying the factual root. And as I once told Alex, literally sitting in this exact spot, you don't always have to be right. You just have to have the right intention to want to get to the truth. As long as you want to get to the truth and that's your intention, that's fine. But what I would say to you, and I say this very plainly to you, is that most people don't care about facts. Most people do not care about facts. I work in the entertainment business. The people in the entertainment business do not care about facts. They only care about facts when it involves a gross. And to be participating not only as at the citizen level, but then also be a public person, and be part of the zeitgeist at different times to be used and abused positively and negatively within the systems that exist today.
Billy Corgan, Smashing Pumpkins.
Homer Simpson, smiling politely. You know, my kids think you're the greatest. And thanks to your gloomy music, they finally stopped dreaming of a future I can possibly provide.
And see how my participation is a constant decision making between either am I helping, am I hurting, am I informing, or am I actually enslaving. You don't see how you've been engineered and steered, and people are heavily invested in convincing you of something. We all know the advertising model. Women very much understand from a very young age, you start being told, you gotta look like this, you gotta think like this, you gotta do this in your hair, blah, blah, blah. Young men, it comes a little bit later. Okay, we all understand that, and it doesn't really bother us. We like when a clever ad manipulates us to want us to buy a certain product or something. What we don't realize is, think about people who have trillions on the line getting you to believe a lie or lean you a certain way so that they can achieve some end that's 10 years down the road that you don't even have the read for.
How do we kind of see through that, knowing of an evolutionary step that we as humans need to take?
I mean, it's pretty remarkable that, like, literally, okay, I'm talking to you, right? I could say one word right now that would destroy my career. I could use the wrong racial epithet or say the wrong thing to you or look down at the wrong part of your body and be castigated and it's a meme and I'm a horrible person. You have to start by separating the truth. I think admitting to yourself your own truth is always a good place to start.
Rock star Billy Corgan on the fascist attacks on free speech. Premiering this week on The Alex Jones Show.
And again, as you just heard in that interview, Billy Corgan of Smashing Pumpkins, very wise, very articulate, very insightful. That is going to be a very interesting interview. That's a trailer for it. We're going to have the 30-minute interview is going to premiere live tomorrow on The Alex Jones Radio Show. So don't miss it. Let's go back to our callers now who've been waiting for a long time. James in California. James, thank you for holding.
Yeah, hi, David. How's it going? I came across a video on YouTube. It was a recording of a news show that's on GCN Live, and I didn't catch the host's name, but he had a guest on, and I'll describe basically the best I can what he's talking about. But basically what he's saying is that we are right now in double top secret martial law. The Joint Chiefs of Staff, I guess the Army General, is really in charge. And they raided the Federal Reserve Bank and shut it down completely. And now they're going, or they have been, or starting to print gold-backed dollars in Reno, Nevada. And, I know it's kind of weird. But anyways, it kind of got me thinking, because the largest gold-producing mine, commercial mine, is actually located in northern Nevada. I don't know if that has anything to do with it, but I was wondering if, you know, if you guys heard anything about this, or if it's something you guys can look into. But
sure, we'll look into it. I don't have any information about that. I can't verify that. I'll tell you this. I would say that we are under martial law, and it's not any secret. I would say that we're under martial law. How else could you describe the situations that we have, where we have to have the government put their hands all over our bodies for us to fly anywhere, or x-ray us, or make any of these unconstitutional demands? Just as we're talking about civil asset forfeiture, for 3 decades now, or 4 decades, we've had the government feels that they can stop you alongside the road and seize your property without charging you with a crime, let alone finding you guilty. I mean, isn't that martial law? I mean, how much more do they have to do to suspend the rule of law, to suspend trials? I mean, how they can... they create the FISA court, the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act, that was created because of abuses that were happening in the 1970s that the Church and Pike Committee hearings pointed out. So they create something that's going to keep that in check and yet still try to keep our secrets. So they use that. They turn that into a star chamber that does dragnet surveillance on all Americans. I mean, it's Big Brother that they're applying to everybody here, and yet for the people who aren't really paying attention, what they get is a brave new world. I would say that we are under martial law. I don't know what's happening with generals. I don't see any evidence of that personally. I haven't seen anything. I've heard a couple of reports of people talking about that. But quite frankly, they don't have to declare martial law. They're just getting us there step by step in a de facto process. That's what I see happening, James. Thank you so much for holding, and I want to get to some of these other callers while we still have time. Let's go to Stephen in Alabama. Stephen.
Hello there, sir. Thank you for what you do.
Thank you. Thank you for listening.
Just recently, I think the last 3 months, I've gotten a PhD, I feel like. But a few questions I wanted you to ask in learning and stuff I've always known. I'm a blue-collar guy. I'm an electrician. My father worked for a defense contractor. My mother is a Sunday school teacher, been doing it for 40 years. They're still together. But is Donald Trump, is there, I've never seen anything like this in my life where, I graduated from college and political science, criminal justice. My girlfriend was murdered, and I decided that's not the line of work I want to go in. They executed the guy, and I prayed for his family. And it's a tough thing. It changed me.
I understand.
God, what a change. What a change. Christopher Eugene Brooks.
I talked about an experience in my family last night as we're looking at Barack Obama saying that felons are new protected class as far as discrimination goes. So if you're a landlord, you can't discriminate against somebody who's a felon. My aunt and uncle were murdered by a felon that they didn't know he was a felon when they rented to him. He got way behind in his rent. They eventually, after about 6 months, they told him they were poor. They were living in the other side of the house. They said, we have to evict him, you know, and we have to evict you. We can't keep carrying you here. And it was a small amount of money. He paid them and then came back and murdered them, brutally murdered them. And when I look at Barack Obama saying that we can't discriminate against people who are felons moving into our home, I mean, quite frankly, this is the open border situation taken to your own front door, to your home. This is where the logical conclusion of this is. He's letting people who are illegals, terrorists coming across, drug cartels coming across the borders. He could care less about our safety. And if we want to protect the borders, then we are racist. And now he's telling you, if you don't rent your home, maybe the home that you live in, like my aunt and uncle, if you don't rent that home to someone who is a convicted felon, this guy was a rapist, then he became a double murder, then you are racist. No, they weren't racist at all. But I'm sorry, I just had to inject that. What were you going to say about Donald Trump? Of course, it is something we've never seen before. I've never seen the kind of enthusiasm for a presidential candidate that we see for Donald Trump. That's part of what I've never seen before. I've never seen the establishment uncloak and talk and show their true colors like they're showing their true colors now. What did you want to say about that, Stephen?
I hope you have a seven-second delay. I didn't mean to say that word, the D word, but I'd said a long time ago, I said, this is going to uncloak. And an analogy. You know the WWF, World Wrestling Federation, where these guys pretend to get out in an arena and sure. fight each other.
Sure.
And but at the end of the day, my grandfather, I come from a family where there's only two divorces in six generations. And we're just good blue-collar folks. I'm an electrician.
Right.
And my father worked for a defense
So do you
contract.
Think that you think that Trump is going to wake people up? Do you think he's going to change things, or do you think he's part of the WWE game?
He's already done it. And here's something that I want to get out there. I remember back when I'm 48 years old, and I remember back during the Reagan years, the Reagan years. Reagan was, I think he was a true patriot.
Yeah, but I think when he took over, I think he wanted to make peace with the establishment. He did it the first time when he challenged Gerald Ford in 1976. He reached out to Schweikert, I believe is the guy's name, if I remember correctly, who was part of the liberal establishment, said, you know, he'll be my VP choice if you guys let me be president. He did the same thing again in 1980, and they nearly killed him for it. And then once he became president, even though he was not a member himself of the Council on Foreign Relations, he put 360 people in the CFR and the State Department. So, you know, it is, we always have to be concerned that they don't sell out, that they don't get co-opted by the establishment system. And I hope that doesn't happen with Trump. Thank you, Stephen. I want to try to get some of these other people who've been holding for a long time as well. Let's go to Jeff in Missouri. Jeff.
Hey, David. How are you, my friend?
Doing good.
Good. I know you guys are short on time. You guys absolutely really do continue to inspire. I've had actually a podcast that I've had Staff Sergeant Joe Biggs on, which I'm so thankful for. I actually have a new podcast called The Conspiracy Farm with USC Hall of Famer Pat Miletich. We just had on Sean Stone, Peter Schiff the other day. Like I say, you guys have lit the flame, I guess, of liberty, and it's catching on, man.
That's good.
Another comment. I am absolutely dreading my co-host Pat Miletich sent me something on Facebook the other day that Dennis Miller had said about not that he liked it, but the inevitability of a Hillary Clinton presidency. And I can't say enough to you, sir, how much I dread that prospect. What are your thoughts?
I don't think it's inevitable. I mean, why do you think it's inevitable? Why does why did he think it was inevitable?
An anomaly. We see historically what happens to anomalies because the machine just doesn't allow that to happen. Look what they're doing. The popular vote is saying, as far as on the Republican side, we want Donald Trump. And they're just like, we don't care. They're going to usurp that. So if he does happen to get in office and put things into place that he wants to, I like my co-host says, wear a bulletproof vest or something, because they're going to, they normally eliminate anomalies like this historically.
Well, you know, we were told by everybody, all these experts have told us from the very beginning, and they repeated the message week by week by week by week that Donald Trump was not going to last. He was going to get out. We were told that Jeb Bush was inevitable because he had $150 million in the bank with his super PACs that he had raised. So don't even bother. You know, that was a shock and awe campaign of Jeb Bush. Where did they go? I mean, you know, this has been an unprecedented campaign, and he hasn't even started on Hillary Clinton. I think the key thing that and when we go back and look at Reagan, for example, in 1980, in the spring, early summer, he was still 15 points behind. He was running against a seated president. Now, Jimmy Carter was not a strong president, but nevertheless, that is a tremendous advantage. Reagan was 15 points behind. Donald Trump is doing way better than that now, and he's doing way better than Mitt Romney did at this point. So I think at this point, he's willing to do things that the Republicans would not do. He's willing to expose the skeletons in Hillary Clinton's closet the way that they never exposed them. And he is not going to shy away from doing any of that. I think he's going to be a very strong candidate. I think it's going to be an amazing race. And I think we're going to see a lot of curtains pull back, a lot more than we've already seen. I think it's a great thing that we see Jeb Bush and Mitt Romney and all the Bushes, as a matter of fact, and not that they're going to boycott the nominating convention. Good, good. Why don't you go and start a third party and let's let the American people take over the GOP, or let's change the system so that we can have a rise of another party. I think that's an important thing to happen, but it's very important that we have somebody who has pushed back against political correctness. That's caused him to fire all the triggers on the social justice warriors. They are beside themselves, and it's going to simply be more of this type of thing happening. We're going to see more and more exposed, and we're going to out the people definitively who have supported a globalist agenda. There is no difference at the top between the Republicans and Democrats, and we now see that as these people start to line up behind Hillary Clinton, the Wall Street people move behind them, the talking heads that supposedly represented conservatism, who supposedly represented the GOP, they're now saying they will support Hillary Clinton. We know what their agenda is. It's globalism. Just as the last agenda was to get health care pushed through here in America, now they want these globalist treaties, they want the open borders, and they want the climate treaties pushed through. Thank you so much, Jeff. Let's go quickly to Adam in California. Adam, go ahead.
Hey, how you doing?
Doing good.
So I have a 30-year-old millennial. Actually, I'm 28, but I've been, you know, dealing with computers my whole life, programming, technology, and things like that. And I've been listening to the show for about 4 weeks now, and, you know, you're pretty much spot on with everything. But I've been waiting for a conversation about blockchain technology to come up, and it came up today, and that's why I'm making this call. Mm-hmm. I know there were conversations about the banks potentially using this against us or as far as centralizing a digital form of cash, but I don't think that can be done. And I'd like to provide an example. For example, we could use blockchain technology for presidential elections for casting a vote. You know, every transaction that's casted, you know, we can create a blockchain that keeps tallies of a vote. You know, the blockchain is managed by a network of nodes that all have their own copy of the database.
Well, I understand that, and I agree with you about the blockchain, and I've heard people talking about that in order to keep the elections honest. But just like you could have the elections themselves be honest, and then the people who tabulate the votes could rig it, what we're talking about is not the blockchain per se, but they're taking that blockchain technology, if I understand this correctly, they're taking that blockchain technology out of Bitcoin and putting it into something else. This is a company called Chain, and they're working with the major banking companies, and those banking companies are not going to protect your anonymity. Okay, that could be the mechanism by which they do the cash exchanges so they could verify that it is going to be a legitimate exchange using blockchain technology. But this Chain company, if I understand correctly, they're going to use this as their way of moving money digitally so that they can make anonymous cash criminal. And I think once they do that, they're going to move against anonymous things like Bitcoin as well. Stay with us. We're going to take a break, and we'll be right back. This is a song, Money, 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 which fortunately I'd never heard before. It was featured in a Wired story that we're going to talk about in just a moment. Of course, we were just talking to Adam from California. We were talking about the cashless society. And we had this story on Wired magazine yesterday about how one Swede will kill cash forever. And, of course, that's the guy who wrote that song you just heard, the guy from ABBA. Of course, he has a big following still in Sweden, even though most of you probably don't know them or wish you had never heard of them. We're going to talk about that story in just a moment. Before we do, real quickly, I want to let you know about a new special we have. You can get a ProPure Big or a King unit, and we will give you a choice of one free gift. You have two gifts, both about $70 in value that you can choose from. The first one is a ProPure fruit-infused water pitcher. Now, it holds, it's got a container there for your fruit that you can mix together with your filtered water to flavor it with oranges, lemons, whatever you choose to do. It's a really clever invention. That's $70 value. You get that for free if you buy a ProPure Big. That's the large countertop gravity-fed water filter, or a King unit. Also, you can choose instead of, if you want to get the other choice, instead of the fruit-infused water pitcher, you can get a ProMax shower filter, which reduces or removes over 200 contaminants from your shower water, including things like heavy metal, VOCs, pesticides, fluoride, chlorine, pharmaceuticals, and odors. That's also a $70 value. So you can choose from one of those two things as a bonus free gift if you buy a ProPure Big or a King unit. Also, on some of our best-selling InfoWars Select storable food, we still have 30 to 40% off. That's a huge savings on something that you can get right now that's going to last you on the shelf for 25 years. Made in the USA, no GMO, excellent quality, as especially the packaging, too. It's important not only to have good quality food, but to have good quality packaging. Otherwise, it's not going to last as well for you or be as usable as this kind of packaging is. Even after you open this for the short-term use, you can reseal it in Ziploc bags. It's great packaging. You can get 30 to 40% off InfoWars Select Storable Food, some of our best-selling items there at InfoWarsStore.com. Now, as I came in there with the story from ABBA, and there's the article from Wired Magazine, they began, and when we were talking to Michael Snyder, he was talking about the various Scandinavian countries that had were pretty close to having a cashless society already, and how many other countries within Europe have put limitations on the amount of cash that you can take out at any given time, prohibiting all of that. Now, what's behind all this? Well, a good example shows where they are already in Sweden is on April 22nd, 2013, a bank robber goes into a bank. This is the way they began their story and says, I want some cash. They said they calmly explained to him that they couldn't do it because that bank had absolutely no cash on the premises. And he said, well, where else can I go? And I guess the answer is to another country, because they're pushing pretty heavily towards a cashless society in Sweden. And it's become the campaign of one man. This guy who wrote that song in 1976, Money, 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 his name is Ulvaeus, I guess, if I'm pronouncing it correctly, Bjorn Ulvaeus. He began his war against cash because his apartment complex, actually his son's apartment complex, was broken into. They got kind of nervous about that, feeling that somebody would be back. And yes, they did come back a few weeks later. They stole a bunch of stuff. And he said, I started thinking, they took these things, and what are they going to do? They're going to convert it into paper bills. What if there wasn't any paper money? So he began a crusade to get rid of cash because, you know, cash is criminal. Well, no, not completely. Okay, you can do it in other ways. Remember the interview we just had with the whistleblower from HSBC? It can actually facilitate things, criminal activities, if you have a cashless society. It facilitates things for the big criminals. And, of course, it takes away your anonymity. And when we come back, I'm going to tell you why that's important. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the fourth hour of the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host, and we're going to continue to take your calls. I just wanted to finish up on this article about the cashless society. We saw this on Wired Magazine, came out yesterday, and we were talking about the former band member of ABBA, who is in Sweden, of course. His argument after his apartment was robbed was very simple, they say. The criminal economy depends on the anonymous, untraceable nature of cash. Well, yes, that helps it. And they're going to find, this is kind of like the idea that you're going to stop violent crime by banning guns, okay? Yes, that can be used, but they'll find another way to do it. If you ban cash, there are going to be means of exchange and storage of wealth that are going to continue to be anonymous, whether it's going to be the actual items themselves and some kind of a barter exchange. Most likely, it will continue to be Bitcoin or something like that, some kind of a digital currency. They want to control this, though. Now you see with these bankers meeting in April and a secret meeting talking about how they're going to use the product of this company called Chain, use a BitChain technology to create a digital cash society. They want to make sure that this is not anonymous. That's the key concern that is there. And that's one of the ways that you can avoid being controlled by the government. So that's why they want to take that away from you. They want to be able to track you and tax you with everything you do. And that means digital cash. That means driverless cars. That means a real information highway where they mandate boxes, and they're going to propose this later this year. This year, they're going to start mandating, they're going to come out with proposals to mandate vehicle-to-vehicle communication and vehicle-to-infrastructure communication. So your car is going to be talking to the highway. It's going to be talking to the stoplights. It's going to be talking to the government about how you drive. And they are going to use that to make it too expensive for you to drive your own car. And then they're going to control everything that you do and follow everything that you do. That is what's driving the digital cash issue. It isn't going to stop crime. We just had an HSBC whistleblower telling us that the bank itself was creating fake accounts and then deleting those accounts down the memory hole. It's even easier for them to do it than it is to move big bags of cash around. They can do it with the little bits. And they so it's not going to change the criminal action. And it's not even something that is going to be more safe and more secure. Because look at this story from the Free Thought Project. Anonymous takes 9 central banks offline and unleashes a massive assault on the global banking cartel. So you want to take our anonymity by taking our paper cash? Well, we still have Bitcoin, and some of these hackers have pointed out that you are not secure even in the central banks. They say after a global call to arms, the Anonymous campaign against the global banking industry, Opicarius, I believe is what it was, seems to be gaining major momentum as 8 more financial institutions have been taken down after the initial attack on the Central Bank of Greece, followed by similar denial of service attacks on the Central Bank of Cyprus. I say there's a 30-day campaign against central bank sites across the world. Look, the bottom line is this. They can get all the personnel records of everybody that works for the government, from the Pentagon to all these other bureaucracies, and they can steal that information. They can steal the digital cash. All you're doing is you're making it easier for criminals. You're making it easier for the government to control our lives by taking away physical cash and making this digital. But that's the whole point. That's precisely what they want to do. Let's go back to our callers, Eddie in Arizona. Eddie, go ahead. Got about a minute before we got to go to break.
I'll be very, 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 very brief. The biggest bubble that they're pumping up is the lie bubble, and you guys are bursting that worldwide. Trump, he's probably got about 11 million voters. I would give more, but if everyone gave $100 with 11 million voters, that's $1.1 billion. He does not need the RNC. His VP selection needs to be a general that was fired by Obama, someone they're scared of to be president. It's like a life insurance policy. And one thing I want you to do is to look into Albert Pike and research this. He wrote this letter, and I've researched it, but I can't ascertain if it's 100% true. But it explains why the Muslim immigration's coming in. He was a guy, you know about him. He started...
We've had John Bowne has done a couple of reports on Albert Pike. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're going to go back to your calls in just one moment. We've been talking about the cashless society, the driverless car society. You know, we have open borders, and we're told that it's racist for us to get any documentation or evidence of people who are entering our country walking across the border. And yet, look at this information. Seems like we are capable of screening people coming into our country from some areas. That would be from Britain. We don't want any people coming here from Britain. There's a story that came out about a tourist. Now, since April 1st, they've had new airport rules, meaning that British tourists who are coming to the United States need to have a biometric e-passport before they're allowed to fly the United States. And so there was a story, several UK papers picked this up about one individual. His name is Vic Ryan of Lincoln. He had booked all of his vacation. He had his reservations everywhere for his whole family to take a vacation. And then he finds out that he can't get on the plane because even though he's got a passport, he doesn't have a passport with all of his biometric identification on it. So they screen very carefully for people coming from Britain, you know, because they said this is in response. This is the way they sell it in the papers, okay? They say this is in response to the wake of recent terrorist attacks, you know, like we've had in San Bernardino and Paris and so forth. And it's like, really? I didn't realize that was British tourists that were shooting people in San Bernardino and Paris. Oh, that's right. It wasn't. It was the Muslims that were not allowed to look at what's going on or figure out what's going on, right? But we're going to shut down travel from the UK for these people. Now, it's not just us doing it to the British. They're doing something else that I thought was kind of interesting to the Australians who have, as they put it, the dream of working in Britain. I mean, these are Australian dreamers. These are people who want to go to Britain to work. And they're told that unless they've got a job that makes $72,000 a year, they're not going to be allowed to stay in Britain. They're going to have to leave. And that goes for Americans, too. Any American dreamers who want to go to the UK and work there, they're going to be kicked out under new visa rules if they earn less than $72,000 a year. Okay, so it looks to me like we've got some double standards going on here, don't you think? This is for, they say, non-European workers will have to make $72,000 a year. But it's not going to be, don't worry. They're not going to kick out the migrants who are coming in from Islam, because we don't want to do anything to stop Britain from becoming part of Greater Eurabia. That's not going to happen. Meanwhile, we see, and you might get the idea, that our government wants to replace us. You know, when we go back to the stories that I covered yesterday about Vicente Fox plotting with Nancy Pelosi about how they can defeat Donald Trump, meeting for a half hour with a House Minority Leader who used to be Speaker of the House. And I'm sure she agrees totally with the Speaker of the House, Paul Ryan. Let's all stop Trump. So you got Nancy Pelosi, Paul Ryano, and Vicente Fox, the former Mexican president. They all want to get rid of, they all want to stop Donald Trump. He's looking better all the time, isn't he? And at the same time, we say that illegal immigrants get $1,200 more welfare than American families. They get a couple of $1,000s more than Social Security retirees who've paid into this system their entire life. And, of course, the dreamers who come here don't get thrown out. They get a free college tuition and free schooling that is paid for by your property taxes. So they're essentially coming here to take your home. Because at some point, you're not going to be able to afford to pay for the education of everybody in the world who wants to come to America and be educated at your expense in the language of their choice. That's what we're really talking about here. Let's go back to our callers, Bill in Florida. Go ahead, Bill.
Hey, David. I just wanted to make sure Someone called in earlier. And it's an inevitable Clinton presidency, but we can prevent that. Everybody has to do their own exit polling, and you should never believe the mainstream media who's doing all the polling now.
Yes.
They tried it with Trump. They tried to get out and say, oh, Trump's losing, Trump's behind. And then when he started winning everything, then they had to submit and say, oh, looks like Trump might actually be leading.
That's right.
And as long as you sit there, just give people a piece of paper and like a pencil with your YouTube channel on it and say, tune in if you want to see our results.
That's right. I agree with you. I think the exit polls are very important. Isn't it interesting? They do exit polls, but the mainstream media will break the exit polls down. They won't say, well, we got this many for candidate A, this many for candidate B. What they'll tell you is they say, well, women supported candidate A or men supported candidate B or whatever. They'll break it down demographically, but they won't tell you the actual results for candidate A and B because they don't want people to question the official results. Isn't that interesting? Don't you find that interesting? We have all these polls leading up to it. Boy, they live and die by the poll. Okay, we've got a gazillion polls, and they're all over the place. We're told that they've all got an error, margin of error of 4 or 5%, and yet they're way different from each other in those margin of errors. Nevertheless, they don't do any polls and compare them to the actual results, even on a few precincts. And what you're talking about, I think, would be a very important thing for citizens to do to actually monitor this. Just select a couple of precincts and ask everybody coming out, you know, will you tell me who you voted for or whatever? And you could get a pretty good idea if they're rigging things at that precinct. They don't do that. And when I talked earlier about the election rigging that happened down in Brazil, they had a lot of electronic voting machines there. Going into that election, the female president that they're trying to impeach, this socialist Marxist that's down there, totally corrupt. They're trying to impeach her out of the presidency. And she was down 10% in the polls the day before. She went to a soccer game, had a stadium of 65,000 people boo her. And yet, the next day, she was ahead by 10%. And the company that typically did the exit polls didn't do any exit polls. That was a very telling thing as well. But they did get a large government contract shortly after that to do some other things. It was their payoff. And that's what everybody said it was at the time. Any other comments on how you think people can keep this situation honest?
No. I was just going to say, just film it and then put it on a YouTube channel.
Yeah.
You know, just put it up there. And you had said that before, how they always tell you, oh, that so many people voted about the economy and this and that. But like you said, they never tell you who's leading, how many votes this person got in exit polling, nothing like that. But if you record the whole thing and just put it on YouTube, it'll be right there for the lying thieves to have to, the known liars that nobody trusts.
And we've said even before the Trump phenomenon, we said if people, we understand that there's multiple ways that you can rig the votes, right? You can have bogus voters. You can have, because they've extended the times, people can vote multiple times. They can mess with the count, with the totals. We've seen that happen. We saw that happen with the Ron Paul situation when they phoned in the vote totals. We saw them flipping and switching stuff with that. So there's multiple ways that they can rig it at every level. And, of course, voting machines are a big part of that. But I think at some point, if you show up en masse, and I think this is what's been happening with Donald Trump, people showing up en masse in such large numbers that they kind of back down and say, well, we'll try to take him down in another way. Maybe we'll try to co-op him after the election, or maybe we'll try to make an alliance with him during the election or whatever. They'll come at him from a different direction other than this. And I think that's very important. And I think it's important for us to show up. You know, we have an article here that the radio crew gave me. Business Insider is reporting Ted Cruz doesn't endorse Donald Trump, but he tells Glenn Beck, his good buddy, that he won't rule out jumping back in if he sees, quote, a path to victory. Because, you know, he just suspended his campaign. He didn't end it. That's what they all say. They all say they're suspending their campaign. So if he sees a path to victory, Slippery Ted is going to slip right back in. And that's why I think it's very important. If you live in West Virginia, you're listening to this broadcast, you need to show up to the polls. I don't understand why Donald Trump would go to West Virginia, and he has a massive rally there, and he's telling the people how he supports them, supports their economy. And yet he says, don't worry about it. You don't need to come to vote in the primary. We got it all sewn up. Save your vote for the general election. Look, you don't lose your vote if you vote in the primary. You still get to vote again in the general election. He's not at the magic 1,237 number yet. And I think that if you're in West Virginia, you need to show up and vote there, because it ain't over till it's over, folks. And it's not over. He doesn't have the 1,237 yet. Should not get overconfident about that, and I think that's a big mistake to do that. Let's go to HB in FEMA Region 4. Go ahead, HB.
Yeah, David, good job.
Thank you. Go ahead.
Am I on?
Yes, you're on.
There we go. I can't understand. I don't think that he's going to get in because of the electronic voting machines. Are they going to portray Hillary as being, you know, it's going to be neck and neck, 50-50 with them? And then she's just going to get it when everybody goes to vote, no matter how we vote.
Yeah, it's going to have to be. I think if you've got a close race like that, they'll flip it. That's the easiest way for them to adjust the election to the outcome that they want. If you have to have people show up in massive numbers for them not to flip it. And it's very easy for them to do it with the voting machines. I mean, that's why we want to go back to the simple paper ballots. If anything, just have everybody vote on the same day. Paint your thumb purple. That's the way the U.S. government did it when they wanted honest elections in Iraq. They know how to have honest elections, and they know how to rig the elections. And they can do it however they wish. And that is just one of the ways that they rig the election. So, yeah, I agree with you. If it's a close scenario, I think they will flip it using the voting machines. It's a very easy way for them to rig the elections.
Can I say one thing that's not on target, on subject?
Sure, go ahead.
It's about the globalist long-term infrastructure plans for America. You know, they got these 20, 30-year infrastructure plans, building highways and pipelines everywhere. It doesn't seem like collapse is imminent.
Well, that's true. You know, it's a very long-term plan, and I think they're going to continue going down that path, but we'll just have to see. This election, I think, is fundamentally about nationalism versus globalism. I think people are starting to realize that. They're starting to realize that's a real issue. You know, you can talk about civil liberties, you can talk about a lot of different things, but you're not going to have a Bill of Rights, you're not going to have a Constitution, you're not going to have a country unless you win this war about globalism versus nationalism. We're going to continue to take your calls. I see one person there disagrees with me on Donald Trump, so we'll take them right away. We'll be right back with your phone calls. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host for the rest of this hour, and we're taking your calls. That number is 800-259-9231, 800-259-9231. I just got this article from Kit Daniels. Of course, we've been talking about how Vicente Fox, former president of Mexico, is meeting with Nancy Pelosi. And, of course, they share the same goal as Paul Ryan. They would like to stop Trump. And yet we see that Mexico is taking nearly 4,000 Cuban migrants from Panama and escorting them to the U.S. border, because Mexico doesn't even want them passing through their country. But they're going to dump them on the United States. And, of course, we're racist if we want to patrol our border. But you better believe Mexico patrols their border with Panama, with Nicaragua. They closed their border last year, as it reports in this. So that's what we're seeing everywhere. This is a deliberate takedown of our society, folks. It is very, very deliberate what is happening here. And this is not something that is a humanitarian issue. In my opinion, this is something that is going to cost us our entire country if we don't get control of these borders. Now, let me go to Antoine in California, who says he disagrees with me. Antoine, go ahead.
Hi, David.
Hi.
So what I disagree with is that, you know, I saw a lot of people wearing red and hammering sickles at these Trump rallies, and he doesn't acknowledge, you know, where that's coming from. I'm guessing it's not the Chinese or, like, you know, Alex are the globalists. And, you know, I see a lot of it. And also, Alex likes to, you know.
Wait a minute. You saw people at the Trump rallies that were inside the rallies that were wearing hammer and sickle clothing and stuff like that, supporting communism, right?
Are the people that are starting stuff, burning the American flag.
Okay. Yeah. Right.
So, I mean, it's weird because they everywhere, they all wear red. And now, you know, recently in Southern Cali, they started, you know, having, you know, Mexican flags and stuff like that. The whole year before that, you know, it was all red people. And he talked a lot about how they showed up to his rallies that he would have at abortion clinics. And, you know, they'd be Satanists and stuff. So, it's weird. I looked into this stuff because I have a channel on YouTube called The Orbiter. And it's Satanists is really weird because they everywhere. And he associates that with the hammer and sickle, people wearing red, you know, communism. I don't think that's the Chinese side of communism. I think that's, you know, Russian side of communism. And Alex likes to say they old sweetie baby good guys and stuff. But I heard from the ISIS guy he had on, he said he saw a lot of Russians in one of the episodes, you know, handling some of the ISIS people and, you know, coordinating with them. So this is weird, you know. And I think Donald Trump should probably look into it, and also vaccines, you know, and our health, and all these pharmaceutical commercials that run these Republican evil, you know, people. But they make a lot of money off this stuff, off of him, you know.
I agree with you. I think that I don't think that it's simply a Russian issue, and we have to understand that communism was essentially established by central bankers. Okay, they're the ones who gave Lenin $10 million in Switzerland and sent him on a sealed train to go start the Russian Revolution. And that was, the German central banker whose brother was establishing the Federal Reserve. Alex has mentioned this many times. I've mentioned it as well. So we need to understand that, you know, we don't have capitalism and Wall Street on one side and the communists on the other side. It's the bankers and the Wall Street people who are benefiting from the communist dictators like Hugo Chavez. They brag about the fact they get a 700% return on their investment. That works out really well for them. They love to create the chaos and the division. And, of course, you talk about the ties to Satanism. We've seen one of the tenets of Marxism is that they have to eradicate religion. They call it the opiate of the masses. So there's all this religious persecution that we see is something that these atheist communists and socialists are actively fomenting. So there's that connection there as well. That's not a hidden secret. I mean, we don't even have to say, well, you know, I think that they're Satanists or whatever. They're open about this. This is something we've seen in the past. They turned the churches into museums, or they destroyed them as they went through Russia, as they went through China. I don't really make that much of a distinction between different countries, having their socialist or communist government, or a distinction between communism and socialism. The fundamental thing at the bottom of all of it is a centralized control, a command control economy. And as our government becomes more and more centrally controlled, as they get away from the rule of law and resort to executive orders, as they thumb their nose at the Constitution, like we've seen with the Trade Promotion Authority, and saying, we are going to run this thing through. We're not going to pay any attention to the constitutional process for ratifying a treaty. We're going to take this treaty that was put together by foreigners, by multinational corporations, done in secret, and we're going to ram this thing through in a unique process that has nothing to do with the Constitution. That's what we need to be afraid of, and that's what these people are all uniting with, whether it's Hillary Clinton or Jeb Bush or Paul Ryan. They're all on the same team, folks. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host. We're going to go back to your calls in just a moment, but I want to ask you a question. You know, what if America had a Chernobyl? Do you think that they'd try to keep a secret? Do you think that they would ridicule investigators as conspiracy theorists, as anti-government people because they criticize the government? You know, I wasn't aware of this story until Joe Jennings brought this in. This is something that was released last September. I'm sure we covered it at InfoWars. But this is a one-year investigation that a television crew did in Southern California. And it was absolutely amazing to me. But Joe Jennings noticed this because the people that are dying in Southern California, where his family was, are dying with the same kind of cancer that his dad did. And here's what's behind it. Let me just read you just the intro to this, because this is a very long investigation. There's a lot of detail in this. And if you're not aware of this story from last September, you need to be. So the U.S. government secretly allowed radiation from a damaged reactor to be released into the air over the San Fernando and Simi Valleys in the wake of major nuclear meltdown in Southern California more than 50 years ago. Fallout that nearby residents contend continues to cause serious health consequences and in some cases death. Now they say there was this lab, the Santa Susana Field Lab. They called it Area 4. Isn't that nice? They have those, you know, Area 50, 51 or whatever, the UFO place. Was that Area 59? Whatever, I can't remember. Nevertheless, founded in 1947 to test experimental nuclear reactors and rocket systems, the research facility was built in the hills above the two valleys. In 1959, Area 4 was the site of one of the worst nuclear accidents in U.S. history. Have you ever heard of it before? No. Do you think that there's going to be a lot of things that come to light eventually that our government has hidden from us? Of course. Of course. This has taken 1959. I mean, we're getting close to 60 years, okay, that this has been out there. Not just 50 years, but 60 years. One of the worst nuclear accidents in U.S. history. But the federal government still hasn't told the public that radiation was released into the atmosphere as a result of a partial nuclear meltdown right there in California. Now whistleblowers interviewed on camera by NBC4 have recounted how during and after that accident, they were ordered to release dangerous radioactive gases into the air above Los Angeles and Ventura counties, often under cover of night, and how their bosses swore them to secrecy. The I-team, the NBC I-team, reviewed over 15,000 pages of studies and government documents, interviewed other insiders, uncovered that for years, starting in 1959, workers in Area 4 were routinely instructed to release radioactive materials into the air. And back in North Carolina, we used to live not too far from a nuclear reactor that was put there, and I opposed that from the very beginning. I'm an ardent opponent of nuclear power because there is no long-term solution to storing the waste. As we saw in Fukushima, in most cases, they take the nuclear waste and they store it on-site at the nuclear facilities. But you may not know that nuclear facilities themselves become radioactive after a certain number of years. They need to be decommissioned. They come with a lifetime grant or permission to operate of 20, 25, 30 years. What we're seeing now is these nuclear facilities, like the one in North Carolina, have passed their lifetime license, and they just get their license extended. Okay, let's just extend it for another 20 years. Don't worry about it. And we're starting to see, back at the one in North Carolina, the Sharon Harris nuclear facility there, they're having minor, they tell us, accidents. But of course, you never know, do you? Because you can't see, smell, taste this. Okay, just as the people, nobody knew. Now, for 60 years, nobody knew that they had nearly had a nuclear meltdown. Nobody knew that they were releasing nuclear radioactive materials into the air in Los Angeles County, in Ventura County, okay? They say to prevent a potentially devastating explosion, one that in hindsight, the 76-year-old whistleblower believes would have been just like Chernobyl, he and other workers were instructed to open up the exhaust stacks and release massive amounts of radiation into the sky. He said this was a very dangerous radioactive material, went straight out in the atmosphere, went straight to Simi Valley, to Chatsworth, to Canoga Park. Area 4 workers, of course, were sworn to secrecy. They would never tell anyone what they had done. Yeah. So we see that happening over and over again. Occasionally we see things like Flint, Michigan, where they put the lead in the water, allowed that, knew that it was there, did nothing to protect the people until somebody blew the whistle on them. Bottom line, folks, is that you need to protect yourself. You need to be skeptical of the government. You need to understand that, yes, even in America, we can have a criminal government that endangers the people and lies to us about it and keeps it secret for decades. Now, most of the listeners to this radio program know that. Most of you realize that it wasn't some kind of magic unicorn science that brought down three steel buildings with only two planes. And you realize that the cover story about these Saudi terrorists is just that, a cover story. But you also realize that that's an important way that we're going to begin to unravel the truth, that we're going to begin to unravel the relationships between our secret government, the CIA, and the Saudis. And that's one of the reasons why they want to keep this quiet. They put this in, they had this beard, and then when it started to get some traction, they actually put it in the report. They said, whoa, wait a minute, we don't want our allies sued. But be skeptical. Protect yourself. And, you know, one of the things that we're doing to try to help people prepare, we've run specials on preparedness products. We've got specials on our select storable food. It helps to support our operation. It helps to provide for your future. And make sure that you take advantage of this 30 to 40% that we've got off on our best-selling products at InfoWars Select Storable Food. I don't know how much longer that sale is going to last. It's not going to last much longer, and it's now just on we've just extended it for our best sellers at InfoWarsStore.com. Also, to try to help you make sure that you've got clean water. That's one of the essentials. You know, food and water. Right? Why wouldn't you prepare for food and water? Make sure that you've got a backup source of food that's going to last you a long time. Get it while you can get a discount. Make sure that you've got clean water that in case they dump something into it that you can't detect, you can still get that out. And you know they're putting fluoride in it. You know they're putting chlorine in it if you're on city water. If you're on rural water, you don't know if somebody in some farmer nearby is dumping glyphosates into the aquifer. Okay, so you need to filter this stuff out. If you don't have one now, you should be getting it. We've tried to extend another sale to you here. ProPure Big or King units. If you get one of the large units that sit on the countertop, you can get your choice of a free gift, either a ProPure fruit infused water pitcher. That's a $70 value, or a ProPure shower filter, also a $70 value. That's a good way for you to try that out. And of course, when we talk about the ProPure units, they have water and fluoride filter elements that help to reduce or remove pesticides, herbicides, chloramines, ammonia with chloride, hydrofluorosilicic acid, the latest form of fluoride that is not covered by other fluoride filter brands, and sodium hexafluorosilicate. Okay, so you want to make sure that you're not drinking that stuff. You want to make sure you're not getting bacteria, cysts, and other things that are possibly in your water. Make sure before you realize after the fact that they have somehow slipped this in or forgot to tell you that they had a nuclear meltdown nearly at the reactor in Southern California. They just decided that they wouldn't tell you, swore each other to secrecy. And then do things like, allow the lead to continue to be in the water at Flint, Michigan. I want to go back to our callers. Let's go to Dave in Ohio. Dave, go ahead.
Hey, David. This is Dave from Checker Bar Ice Cream Company in Cleveland, Ohio. I'm going to be donating 5 ice cream carts and $1,000 worth of red, white, and blue bomb pops to pass out during the RNC.
Oh, cool.
And it's going to be distributed from InfoWars, Roger Stone, and Donald Trump.
Oh, that's great. That's great.
Yeah, so we don't have another Ferguson or Baltimore here in Cleveland.
Maybe you can get the people to chill out. You know, screaming in people's faces, just hand them an ice cream cone, you know?
yeah, you know, red, white, and blue bomb pops, ice cream carts. I don't know if you've ever seen them before, going up and down the streets, people mm-hmm. selling ice cream.
That's great.
You know, like,
that's one way to lick the Bernie protesters, right? We can lick them with kindness.
Well, yeah.
And lick them with an ice cream
cone. I can imagine the protesters are going to be coming out here.
Yeah.
So if you got ice cream carts and ice cream bicycles with free ice cream for those, you know, people that don't know any better,
that's
you know,
super.
They get a free bomb pop just because.
That's super. Well, we're going to be there. Alex is going to be there along with the InfoWars crew. I'm going to be staying behind here in the studio kind of, in case we lose communication, we'll keep the broadcast going. But it's going to be an interesting event. I think it'll still possibly be interesting in the convention itself because if Donald Trump is going to tell people they don't need to show up at the primaries, this thing ain't over yet. And we just had the report from Ted Cruz saying, well, I'm going to see if I've got a way to sneak back in here. I'll do it. You can bet he'll do it. This is a guy, his whole life has been trained towards the ambition of being president. We've had his co-senator here from Texas saying he was never interested in being a senator. He always wanted to just be president. I've said that from the very beginning. One of the reasons I think his colleagues in the Senate dislike him so much is because he started climbing over their back immediately. He wasn't interested in being a senator. He was throwing them under the bus to get traction for his presidential campaign. I think that's been it from the very beginning. Well, thanks, Dave. That's going to be real interesting, and I'm sure you'll see Alex and the crew there. That's great. You're going to be donating some ice cream to get people to maybe calm down a little bit at the convention, because I know we're going to have some supporters. And they know that it's these supporters. They know they're not being controlled and manipulated by Donald Trump, because we've had the same thing said about the Democrat convention. We've got the former governor of Pennsylvania who's going to be running the Democrat convention saying the Bernie Sanders people better behave themselves after Bernie doesn't win, because Bernie's not going to win. They're going to make sure, and that's another story right there that we've mentioned, but we really haven't covered that much. We're going to see it again today. What happens is, as long as Bernie Sanders doesn't get more than like a 10% win over Hillary Clinton, she's going to get more delegates than he does. And even if he gets like 10% more delegates, they're going to get the same number of delegates, because they have allocated themselves approximately 10% of the delegates to be superdelegates, and they're all going for Hillary Clinton. So he's got to win by a massive amount to get anything. They'd like to portray it as if they have a very democratic process. They're going to award all the delegates proportionally. But when they do that proportionally, we just saw that happen in the last election in Indiana. He beat her by like 8 points, okay? And they awarded all the delegates proportionally. But then they throw in 10% of the delegates and give them all to Hillary Clinton. So there you go. And they know that it's going to annoy the Bernie Sanders supporters, and they should be annoyed. But we also know how they're going to express that annoyance, and that's what we don't want to see happen. Let's go to, thank you, Dave. Let's go to Caitlin in Connecticut. Go ahead, Caitlin.
Hi, how are you, Dave?
Doing good.
I'm sorry, I'm a new listener, so this is my first time calling in, actually. Thanks so much for having me on the air. I was just wondering if you knew anything about Donald Trump's plan for the FEMA camps and if he's going to be able to get anything done and accomplished in the first 100 days he's in office, because I'd like to see if he can.
Well, you know, he hasn't said anything that to my knowledge, about any FEMA camps. But I think it is interesting the number of topics that Donald Trump has approached. Remember the 28 pages from the 9/11 report? That was something we've talked about many, many times. We've had Congressman Walter Jones on many times from North Carolina. We've had former Senator Bob Graham. He didn't come on our program, but he's talked incessantly about this since he retired in the mid-2000s, and yet nobody got any traction on it until Donald Trump brought it up at one of the debates. And then he was ridiculed by the National Review as sounding like an Alex Jones caller. He sounded like you, Caitlin, according to the National Review. Then things turned when we had 60 Minutes go in and talk to Senator Graham and others who had been trying to blow the whistle on this for the last 15 years. And now nobody is laughing at Donald Trump about that. And of course, he's spoken out on vaccines as well. Even though Ben Carson said that he would support mandatory vaccines, Donald Trump says, hey, I know some employees of mine who had perfectly healthy kids and they got a vaccine and all of a sudden they came down with autism. So he's not afraid to broach these subjects if he agrees with them. And that's a really powerful thing. I think, unlike these other candidates, he's not controlled by the men at the top who are going to tell them there's certain things that are off limits that you don't talk about. I mean, he's like one of you. Now, he could be wrong on something. He could be ignorant about something, just like you and I could be wrong or ignorant about something. But I think if he believes it, he'll talk about it and he'll come out with it. And I think we've seen that over and over again. The Republican Party hates him for that. The media hates him for that. I think that's one of his strongest points. So, yeah, in terms of FEMA camps and a lot of other things, I think that'll be, we'll have to just see what he does. But I think the key issue that this election is about, Caitlin, is nationalism versus globalism. And Donald Trump has been authentic on that for the last 30 years. He's been talking about the travesties of these trade agreements that we have, like NAFTA. He's also complained about the fact that we're paying for everybody else's security. We can't continue to do that with NATO and these other alliances. They don't have to shoulder any of the responsibility, any of the financial burden for their defense. That's what he's talking about with America First. And the reality, folks, is, and I'll say this to the GOP establishment as well, it's what Donald Trump said. Eventually, we're going to go broke from doing this. We can't be the policemen of the world, the unpaid mercenaries of the world. Eventually, we're going to go broke. And guess what? All these countries that people are so afraid of having their own military, like Japan or South Korea or whatever, they're all going to have their own military at that point anyway. So why not allow them to start to wean themselves off of the special breastfeeding that we give them from Uncle Sam? Thank you, Caitlin. Let's go to Stephen in Tennessee. Go ahead, Stephen.
Hello, David. I'm watching you on my Roku device today.
Oh, there you go. That's good. That's a that works out great. That's a great way to watch the broadcast, isn't it?
Yeah, it works really well at my place anyway. But I heard a previous caller mention the Joint Chiefs of Staff that seems to be trying to oppose martial law.
Mm-hmm.
And the one that's doing a lot of it anyhow, is this General Dunford.
Mm-hmm.
And back in January, he did meet with the Federal Reserve Board, and after the meeting, the next day, the Federal Reserve changed their website from .org to .gov.
Hmm. Really? Really? To .gov?
Huh. Yeah, he flew straight from there over to Israel, and that's when they started all the deal about having to bail out Puerto Rico, and Rand Paul was on the campaign trail saying that the Federal Reserve was part of the government now.
Really?
And then last week, or maybe 2 weeks ago, when they were having somebody storm the White House grounds, you know, some crazy guy, Obama did turn over, you know, all executive powers to that General Dunford. And you can look it up on a computer. He says that, you know, during, maybe it was a drill, and maybe it was for 5 minutes or whatever, but he did turn over power to the General Dunford.
Well, we'll have to look that up. I'm not aware of that. So, yeah, that's interesting. We'll take a look at that. Stay with us, callers. When we come back, we're going to take some more of the calls. We've got Frank in North Carolina. We've got Anthony in Arizona. So hang on. We'll be right back after a short break. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. In this final segment, we're going to go back to our callers in just one moment. I was looking at what David Cameron did over the weekend, where he started floating the fear of war for people who would get out of Britain. Of course, we're going to have the Brexit election that's coming up in about, I guess it's 5 or 6 weeks. It's the end of June. They're going to vote whether or not Britain leaves the European Union. And I thought it was ironic that the Prime Minister of Britain, David Cameron, would say, well, you know, this could lead to war, when we've already had two world wars that were supposedly fought to keep Europe from consolidating under German control, to keep from having a consolidated Europe. Which is exactly what they've got, isn't it? And isn't it interesting that 10 years after the end of World War II, at the site of the last Nazi victory, we had the Bilderberg meeting. And at the Bilderberg meeting, as we've talked about, and of course, we're going to be covering the Bilderberg group when it meets this year. At that Bilderberg meeting, the very first one, they came out with a blueprint for European Union, also for the currency, the EU as well. And you can see stories like this one at the New American that came out a couple of days ago. The real agenda behind the CIA spawning the EU. Of course, it's our secret dark government, the CIA. Hail Hydra, okay? These people are the government of the globalist elite. And as one editorial pushing the Brexit says, the EU's commitment to open borders and mass immigration has damaged our national security, as have European laws, which stop us from dealing with terrorists. And, of course, it is the deliberate planned takedown of Europe. And we see this over and over again, and yet people are waking up. We just saw the Austrian chancellor get a drubbing in the election, according to an Austrian paper here. This is a center-left party, which has ruled since World War II with a center-right party. And yet they say, no, there's a far right-wing party, the Freedom Party. Okay, they're going to characterize them as far right-wing. Why? Because they're opposed to the globalist takedown of their countries using open borders. And the interesting thing also, and Drudge had these stories linked up over the weekend, the domino effect seen by half of Europeans, they believe that there'll be a lot of other countries that will leave if the UK exits the EU. And nearly half the voters in EU countries say they want a referendum as to whether or not to remain in the bloc. There's a lot of people that are not happy with the way they're being controlled from one central location. And of course, it's not Brussels and Belgium that's going to be controlling them. It's going to really be the ones pulling the strings are going to be the Germans, and behind them, the globalists, the secret government, the multinational corporations who have created this economic union so they can create a political union. Let's go quickly to your phone calls here. Frank in North Carolina, you wanted to call about the transgender issues there. Go ahead.
Well, I'm not going to really have time to get into it, but I'm kind of suspicious that the mayor of Charlotte, North Carolina, who's the one, along with a non-governmental organization activist who is a registered sex offender, by
yes.
the way, that came
yes.
out later, even though the media here in North Carolina covered that up, when it appears that they knew about it. But, you know, the U.S. Attorney General, Loretta Lynch, she mentioned yesterday that she's proud to be from North Carolina. And I know the Secretary of Transportation, I believe his name is Fox, he's a former mayor here in Charlotte. I'm just wondering if this wasn't all pre-planned and coordinated for this to happen here in North Carolina.
Well, it could be. It could be. And clearly what they have pointed out is that this is not a protected class. This is the way the governor of North Carolina has said. He said, look, if you're going to protect transgenders or transvestites, you need to have the U.S. Congress say this is a protected class of people. That's not what the Civil Rights Act was there for. And I think, maybe you agree with me, maybe you don't, I think the correct way to do this would have been to shut down this regulation in Charlotte and say, we're going to let people at their own businesses, with their private property rights, businesses and churches decide what they're going to do with their bathrooms. And we're going to get the government out of their bathrooms, and we're going to especially get the federal government out, because the federal government has no authority under the 9th and 10th Amendment to do any of this. Join us tonight, 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern, for the InfoWars Nightly.